VAR is heaven.
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 Heaven on earth.
At Virginia International Raceway. Just a beautiful facility here, about 3.25 miles, 160 mile an hour in hardcore racing.
Live in Virginia to take it to the next level. Three races, who will take home the title?
We are ready to go here at this Michelin GT Challenge at Virginia International Raceway.
This will go down in history as one of the finest road courses, if not the United States, the world.
This place is not to be messed with. This place bites. As Paul Newman said, this is heaven.
If you're going to race here and be successful, you have to have discipline.
14 cars the inside lane there. Jordan for the next one. He has to give it up.
You have to have precision.
Try to break a little bit deeper into turn one. Get the elbows out.
You have to have patience. And the margin of error then and now is narrow.
Welcome to NBC Sports coverage of the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship from Virginia International Raceway. Paul Newman said it, heaven on earth. And you can see why. The stars, the cars, the fans, they are all here. A GT-only weekend for the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. It is their time to shine. No prototypes to get in the way. It's all about GT cars. And boy, the colors, the stars are here. And you look down on this facility, and you know why everyone wants to run here. It's the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship, the Michelin GT Challenge at VIR. What an absolutely gorgeous day for racing. Take a look down on the racetrack and take a look at the WeatherTech weather. Temperature in the mid-80s, and yeah, it's a little bit humid, but not too much for these drivers. They'll battle for 2 hours and 40 minutes to get to the checkered flag. Who will get there first? It's going to be quite the contest, and it's an awesome day to do it at this facility. In the GTD Pro category, the championship and the trophy looks like this. Leading the championship right now, Jack Hawksworth, Ben Barnicote aboard their number 14 Lexus. They own it, but the Corvette boys won it. Only 169 points back. Don't forget about WeatherTech Racing and their AMG Mercedes, 260 points back. And what about defending champions, Fab Motorsports? They're still in it. And Ross Gunn, who drives the number 23 Heart of Racing Aston Martin, he has two track records here, both in Aston Martins in GTD Pro. There's more with Matt Yoakum.
Brian, for the third time this year, Vassar Sullivan is on pole, chasing their season's third win. Now, past champions will tell you there's always one defining moment during their historical season. Now, for Vassar Sullivan, they may look back to Canada as season's end because it certainly wasn't a win. It was their first non-podium finish of the season, but it forced the team to do a wake-up call, to look at the task at hand, focus, and be mistake-free. Sully Sullivan, the co-owner, told the team this morning, no need to do anything extraordinary, just do ordinary extraordinarily well, meaning don't beat yourself. In GTD, the magic number has been won.
Madison Snow continues to lead for Paul Miller Racing. Had a tremendous amount of fuel save.
What a wild scramble to the finish. And Paul Miller Racing, leader BMW 1-2. Awesome stuff.
Sellers putting it all on the line to try and maintain that track position. Risk versus reward. That could be the move for the win. Paul Miller's BMW team.
Winners again. Back-to-back victories.
Ryan Sellers, Madison Snow, came into Canada with the championship lead. Well, guess what? They'll extend that lead. It is a go-fast racetrack.
A phenomenal effort in that car for Brian Sellers and Madison Snow.
That's four wins on the season. That's more than they have ever had in a season. And that is going to be a big, big help in their championship run.
And man, what an incredible season it has been for the Paul Miller Racing BMW camp of Madison Snow and Brian Sellers. Four wins on the season, and even more so, carrying a ton of momentum. After sweeping the last race out here for IMSA at Road America, they collected the pole and went on to win that race. Well, the momentum's carried over. They've got that same pace going because in yesterday's qualifying session, they set the top speed lap in GTD, capturing that pole. And man, the BMWs have been fast all weekend here at VIR. So that being said, VIR, one of the trickiest race tracks that we go to, and you'll see here this afternoon that it's going to test even the most skillful and patience of drivers, Brian.
Well, thank you, Matt and Hannah. Plenty more from them, I'm sure, throughout this event today. IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship from VIR. More coming your way with the green flag right after this. Looking down on the green space that is Virginia International Raceway. Michelin GT Challenge at VIR for the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship about to get going. Look at the crowd that is on hand. Welcome in, everyone. I'm Brian Till along with Calvin Fish. We'll have all the action for you today. And Calvin, while I look at these championships in GTD Pro and in GTD, they may seem comfortable, but there's still plenty of hurdles to overcome in the next three races. I think one of the biggest ones may actually be this racetrack.
I'm with you, Brian, because the numbers that those teams are putting on the boards are rarefied air. If they continue to execute like they're doing, they'll be tough to beat. But you come to VIR, you can't rest on your laurels here. The track is the challenge, because over the years we've seen, if you make a little misstep here, there's a lot of jeopardy involved. It is high speed, it is big commitment, but if you make that little mistake, your day may be over. And that's what the championship leaders cannot afford to do. Add to that, they have a target on their back. They have big championship leads. Every contender knows that they have to eat into that margin here today, or it may be getting too late. Also, Brian, you and I have been here. This is the time in the year where the drivers want to get their contracts done. They can't afford to make mistakes. They have to impress if they're going to get a seat and get the attention for the 2024 season.
So you need to win the race. So you need to win the championship. You may need to win a job by the end of this weekend. So with a lot of challenges, like we talked about, you look at the Michelin starting grid there on the left side of the screen. This should be the final warm-up lap, and then it is go time here at VIR. Lights out on the Lexus safety car, and we're about to go green. And what are we going to see, Calvin? The cooler temperatures today may be a big help for these Michelin tires, I would think.
I think so. I mean, yesterday it was extremely hot in qualifying. The drivers talked about within three or four laps, the cars were skating around because of the extreme temperatures. Also, the cockpit temperatures were high. We saw drivers really struggling in some of the other races here this weekend. So we've had a little reprieve in the weather. It's about 10 degrees cooler in terms of the ambient. But nonetheless, we talked about it. The challenge is this racetrack, hitting your marks and understanding what you need to get done. So for the pole sitter, Jack Hawksworth, he knows he has a big championship lead. But Danny Unkadea alongside him, he knows he has to go for it here.
Oh, and what are you thinking if you're Jack Hawksworth? You know you're holding on to that championship lead, and you've already said it, Calvin. There's a little bit of desperation. Desperate times call for desperate measures for some of these drivers, and you wonder how willing are they going to be to attack. And for Jack Hawksworth, he's surrounded side and behind by other GTD Pro cars. The only car he doesn't really have to worry about is the GTD car that's directly behind the number one BMW of Madison Snow. Here we go. Are we ready? Waiting for the drop of the green flag. Jack Hawksworth is ready to go. There it is. The Bendham waves the green. We're racing at VIR, and it is a drag race to turn one.
Hawksworth takes that inside lane. The Mercedes, the WeatherTech entry, tries to go the long way around the outside. That red, white, and black car is our GTD pole sitter, Madison Snow, trying to get the inside of Garcia, who's driving that yellow Corvette, currently fourth in line.
And Yukidea on board the number 79 WeatherTech Mercedes. You're riding with him right now. Hawksworth just in front, and that day glow yellow Lexus trying to hold down that spot. You need to get these Michelins up to pressure, up to temperature before you can really do battle, but you can't hang back too much either.
Argy Bargy there through the snake with a second Lexus. Lots of action mid-pack in GTD.
GTD Pro and GTD doing battle. We say it's a GT-only weekend. If you want to know the difference between the classes, just look at the end plates on the rear wing. Look at the mirror colors. Pro class is red highlights. GTD is green highlights. Otherwise, the cars run to the exact same specs, the exact same balance of performance. The only difference is in GTD, you will have what we call an M-class driver sharing with a pro in the car.
Great start by Hawksworth.
What do you need?
Yeah, the first box of the day to be ticked. He's done it magnificently. Got the start, got the lead down into turn one, protected that inside lane, and he's taken off a little bit from the Mercedes.
Battle starting to rage behind. It's the yellow Corvette, Antonio Garcia. Talk about frustrating. They've had a frustrating year. They're second in the championship. They just haven't had the performance that they wanted in this final season of the factory program here with Brett Miller.
Yeah, they're one of the teams. If they have an opportunity to get to that Lexus today, you know they're going to seize it. They have to go through it. So if there's any crack in the door from that Lexus in terms of strategy, in terms of pace, the Corvette boys, Garcia and Jordan Taylor, are going to be making a move.
What's the mindset, Ben Barnico and Jack Hawksworth, with this championship on the line? The lead, we talk about it as being relatively comfortable. Are they going to let people by, or are they just going to do what they've done all year long?
Well, I think Matt alluded to it, talking to Sully this morning. In fact, we just got to keep doing what we're doing as a team. We've been executing brilliant stuff. I mean, they've only finished off the podium one time in the last 12 races. That dates back to summer of 2022. So they've got the chemistry. They've got the longevity of the crew working together for a long time now. And they're ticking all the boxes. Barnico and Hawksworth here behind the wheel now have just been tremendous behind the wheel. They've got great chemistry. They come from a similar part of the UK. They can actually understand each other. They've got pretty thick accents.
Up through the snake, the climbing essence, turn 10.
What a ribbon of asphalt that is, from 6 to 10, flat out in these race cars. Cars a little bit heavier right now, full fuel load. See Hawksworth just inching away from the Mercedes.
This is actually what I think is one of the most difficult areas of the racetrack, turn 11 and 12. Two of the slowest corners as well, but if you don't get off of Oak Tree, you're going to suffer down this long straightaway.
What we're looking at here is turn 12, Oak Tree corner. You used to have a big Oak Tree there, unfortunately went away a few years ago. But the preceding corner, you're going to see some problems there. I anticipate one or two cars getting off the road there. You try and rush into Oak Tree, you run wide, particularly as we get some marbles out on the racetrack. As the tires start to wear a little bit, you've got to be on your toes through that sector.
Hawksworth using every inch of racetrack right now. You saw him on the curbing at the turn in, down in the middle of the roller coaster through Hogpen. That's the final corner onto the front straightaway. And I'm impressed with the lead that he's been able to build in these first two laps.
Yeah, he looks pretty comfortable. I mean, the key is the longevity, the tires, the durability. Can he maintain the balance in the race car? A little bit cooler, that should help.
What do you do between qualifying and the race, Calvin, as far as setup goes? Do you do anything? You got to feel like you're looking for that one magic lap in qualifying. And as you just said, you're looking for longevity of the stint here at the race.
Well, we talk about the fact that this team is dominated with this Lexus in GTD Pro and is the oldest car in the field. But what that gives you is a bigger notebook to work with. You've been here many times. You'll have been here with similar track conditions. That's the key. Don't be afraid to utilize that knowledge and maybe tweak on the race car a little bit before the off today, looking at the conditions you're going to be racing in today.
Danny Yankadea in the number 79, that beautiful white Mercedes AMG. It wasn't so beautiful on Friday. It had some char marks on the side of it. It wasn't because they went to the barbecue. It's because the barbecue kind of came to them in pit lane.
Yeah, a little flash fire, unfortunately, when they disconnected the refueling rig. Admin shut off. Caught fire, I think, hit the exhaust on the side and also the right front rotor, which was hot coming off the racetrack. Crews, marshals went to work. No one was injured, fortunately, in the car. Had a light scar, but they went to work, buffed it out, and were ready for the next morning. Put together a great qualifying run. Yankadea felt he could have been on the pole, but now he's feeling the pressure from Antonio Garcia right behind him in that yellow van. Looking to the inside. There goes Garcia for P2.
Really feel like Yankadea right there just said, okay, you got the best of me right now. It is way too early in this 2-hour and 40-minute contest to go door handle to door handle and scuff up some paint right now. You got me right now. We're going to get you back in just a bit. IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship from Virginia International Raceway. It is on, and we'll bring it all to you when we come back on the other side of this. IMSA Racing on NBC Sports is brought to you by Acura, precision crafted performance. By Michelin, track to street, perform on all roads with legendary Michelin Pilot tires. And by Lexus, experience amazing. Back at VIR, and this is a big one. We talk about this racetrack being challenging, Calvin, right now for the 92. Big, big impact.
Yeah, Brulee's had an offer. You can see the consequence. We talked about it, Brian. The challenge of this racetrack is high speed. And if you get it a little bit wrong, you can see the damage to this Porsche. The team has had a really solid year. They're not right up their top places in points, but Alec Udell has had 3 podiums this year, so it's been a really solid debut season for this Kelly Moss with Riley Motorsport team, but their day is done early, it looks like.
Trying to figure out exactly where that was. It looked like it kind of in part of the climbing S's. I'm looking on our dancing ants, trying to see where that car is. Actually, he's being shown coming out of
it's in the snake,
that's
I think.
Where he is.
Yeah, it's in the snake.
Yeah,
turn 5.
So safety team on site instantly. Significant damage to the wall on the right, and the crew going to work. The AMR safety crew up at the top of the shot, top left. gets wide coming out of there. Big impact with the right side of the car. Gets the tires up and over the wall, and the car then spins to a stop there in the middle of the straightaway. It looked like coming through that left-hand bend, turn six, the car just slid out to the right. Big impact. Will David Brulé out of the car, which is good to see. We'll take a break, and we'll come back to VIR. That was a significant impact. VIR will bite, and it has. Welcome back to Virginia International Raceway. Some great shots from our WeatherTech aerial coverage. We'll have those all day long for you, looking down on this facility that Paul Newman called heaven on earth. And you can certainly see why. The crowd, absolutely huge. Parking area almost completely full. And that's good news for the fans. They're going to see some great racing. Right now, though, under full course caution. So, Calvin, let's take a moment. If you're going to win at this racetrack, there are going to be some keys that you have to get it done. Let's take a look.
You're talking about this being like heaven on earth, and you got to keep between heaven's gates, because if you run offline, as we saw with David Brulé there, it can really catch you out. Watch your temperatures. The team's really been working with the cockpits this weekend to make sure that they're getting maximum cooling to their drivers, making sure, obviously, the air intakes to the brakes and the engines is where it needs to be. And then the undercut potential. What that means is when you get deep into a stint, when the tires start to degrade a little bit, lose a little bit of their edge, come in early, get a fresh set of Michelins on there, use that performance from that Michelin tire to maybe leapfrog your competition. I think there's some big windows to make that happen here today.
Well, the strategy already starts to get mixed up a little bit with this early yellow. David Brulé's car being loaded on the rollback. That's good. It was good to see him walk away and climb into the AMR safety vehicle. We'll take another quick break from Virginia International Raceway and be back to more GT-only action in the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship.
This is already the eighth year for the Michelin GT Challenge at VIR, and racers, families, and car clubs come from across the entire region to celebrate the top tier of production car-based IMSA racing. Part of the appeal is the track itself. In fact, editors of Car and Driver call VIR America's toughest track and have held their lightning lap shootout here since 2006. VIR is challenging with long straightaways, heavy braking and acceleration zones, elevation changes, and fast flowing technical corners. For Michelin, VIR is familiar territory and a frequent testing site, as many of the GT manufacturers racing here chose tires from the Michelin Pilot Sport family for their top production models in that lightning lap shootout. And completing the circle, teams like this WeatherTech Mercedes will compete on the same Michelin Pilot Sport S9M race slick available for track day use with club, vintage, and track day performance enthusiasts.
Really cool stuff, and you look down on the paddock, it's not hard to find the Michelin compound. You see it there, the blue tents, the yellow highlights that scream Michelin to you as soon as you drive down that main drive into the paddock. And what a great job they do. You think about a tire that they make that really works for all the different manufacturers that are out there. That's pretty impressive stuff.
It is quite the challenge, and they do such a phenomenal job. Just really the benchmark in terms of tire performance here. And you need it around this racetrack, because it asks for everything, as Hannah alluded to. Acceleration, high G-load corners, big braking zones. It gives you a little bit of everything here at Virginia International Raceway.
So going to work here on the guardrail and the tire wall, getting that sorted. Meanwhile, Hannah, what do you have on the 66?
Well, the 66, as you can see, that Gradient Acura right now, Sheena Monk behind the wheel of it. And what a year it's been for herself and, of course, her teammate of Catherine Legg. Sheena getting kind of the call up here to the GT class in WeatherTech. And she said every time she's gone to a racetrack, it's been a huge learning curve for her. But here at VR, she had some experience. But she even told me that first practice session when she got behind the wheel of this Acura, she somewhat felt like a deer in the headlights. But the biggest thing that she said the motto for this year has been is lean into the uncomfortable, because that's the only way you're going to get comfortable. And Sheena and, of course, Catherine, singing her praises about the jumps that she's been able to make behind the wheel of this Acura. But talking to that team and kind of how they feel like they fare out this weekend at VIR, they said usually the Acura runs great here at VIR. They are good on the side of tire deck, but something has been amiss with the tire degradation. It's been very high, and they maybe credit that to the fact that they haven't been able to play with setup so much because they've been so focused on getting Sheena up to speed and getting her comfortable in that car. So we'll have to see how that plays out. Of course, Catherine, she'll climb behind the wheel of the car a little bit later, Matt Yoakum.
Hannah Patrick-Pilet now 11th overall in the FAF portion. It certainly has not been a typical Plaid year, only one win on the season compared to last year where VIR was their season's fifth win on their way to the GTD Pro Championship. They have certainly struggled with this new portion. Now, last year, they won on fuel mileage. They're pulling a page out of last year's playbook. They're going to roll with that again. They were telling Patrick-Pilet, go into fuel conservation mode, and also when you're looking at risk, go with the low risk game plan because they're trying to play the long game here. It paid off a year ago. They're hoping it does again here today.
Yeah, and I think to your point, Matt, when we were on board with Patrick, I noticed he's just really getting out of the throttle as he gets into the brake zone down into turn one. That's how you save fuel, Brian. Not so much running less RPM through the gears. It's just really cracking the throttle, coasting into those brake zones and saving a little bit right there. And they were doing it very early in this race.
Well, it's like we always say, if you're going to save, you got to start early. If you really want to get the dividends late, you can't wait until the final portion to begin to save. Crews right now trying to save the tire wall, get the barriers back in place so we can go back racing here at Virginia International Raceway. It won't be long. Big Ten football is coming back to NBC and Peacock to kick things off. West Virginia and Penn State, the premiere of Big Ten Saturday night. You ready? Get ready, because here comes Saturday night. Looking forward to that. You're looking forward to football season?
Absolutely.
You're a football fan.
I love it. Yeah, I do. I get into it.
Real football?
Yes. Coming from the UK, I guess. Not soccer, but I love soccer. Premier League has just been phenomenal. It's just got going as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, we got some of that. Don't worry. We got everything for you.
It's going to be a busy offseason.
Well, it's getting ready to get busy here at Virginia International Raceway because we're about ready to go back to green. And this full course caution, lengthy as it is, Calvin, that's really going to change a lot of people's strategies, I would think.
Yeah, because you're at the point in this race, if you made a pit stop, you could do it on one more stop to the finish. Full lean in terms of saving fuel. You can go about 70 minutes with these machines. So with 2 hours, 15 minutes to go, you're right in that window of one more stop if you stop now.
Who's going to do it? Jack Hawksworth is in the throttle big time off a hog pen. Onto the front straightaway. Does he dive? No, not yet. Any takers behind him? No. Back to green flag here, and you immediately see Antonio Garcia weaving in that Corvette, that bright yellow number 3 behind the Lexus, trying to build some temperature in those Michelin tires. They were getting ready for this restart. You want to make sure you get it done. Talk about getting it done. Good passing going on there into turn one. Laura Spinelli aboard the Lamborghini. I knew it ended in a vowel.
Yeah, Spinelli up on the wheel, a little bit of argy-bargy there with Mike Skeen, the two green cars there, about fifth, sixth back in line. Nice restart there, but gained by Hawksworth, really controlling this race very nicely. There's a move. That's Patrick Pilet. Inside, I think, was Patrick Gallagher, the Turner Motorsports M4. So he's been saving fuel, but now when you get that compression of the field, that's when you've got to go for and try and get some of that drag position.
What happened to not take risks on passes?
It's Patrick Pilet. He's not afraid to put it in a small window of opportunity like that one.
Well, and again, the control that these guys have is like an NFL quarterback throwing a pass. You look and you go, well, how did they ever fit the ball in there? But these pro drivers are just that accurate. Jack Hawksworth, he's done what he did at the start, Calvin. That car looks so good. The Lexus that's underneath him looks so good on starts and restarts. He's immediately jumped out several car lengths in front of Garcia.
Here comes our GTD leader getting a run on Danny Yunkadea. Pretty tight though as you get down to this brake zone as you enter the roller coaster, and Yunkadea is going to have the inside line for that right hander. So you get alongside, you'll give someone that left hand lane, because if you kind of stick out a little bit like Yunkadea did, you suddenly got that position to take the position back as you turn into the roller coaster here.
So that's GTD versus GTD Pro. And you and I talked about this at dinner the other night about how aggressive do you want to be. And for Yunkadea, he's saying, I'm not fighting you for position, but I don't want you in between me and the car directly in front of me. I need to go chase Antonio Garcia. I don't need to deal with you right now. So he didn't make it easy by any stretch of the imagination.
And conversely, for Madison Snow, he would love to get that white Mercedes between him and that bright yellow Lexus driven by Aaron Tielitz right behind him. So some of these teams have elected to start their higher graded driver in the Pro-Am ranks in GTD. You have a Pro and an Am rated driver in your car. Typically, you qualify your Am driver, get your Pro in to finish the race. Tielitz is in on the 12 car, and Spinelli's in the 78, so they've got an opportunity to do a double driver change or put the load back on Monte Calvo and Goikberg for the end of this race.
It has been very, very warm throughout the weekend. This is the coolest day by far. I'm thinking that some of those decisions, Calvin, to start the higher rated driver was to do that double driver change on the two pit stops. Is that maybe changed now with this long yellow that we had at the very beginning?
Well, a lot will depend on the delta, the difference in speed between your Pro driver and your Am driver. Frankie Montecarlo who really got up on the wheel in his 12 machine. So they have options there. The same thing as Madison Snow. He's got almost the same speed as Brian Sellers, the Pro, in that championship leading number one. So that gives you flexibility. You're not locked in. You can really make a bit of a change, and then maybe you get a pit stop at yellow and you're not ideal with your drive time. You can go in a different direction. That is a big advantage to have when you have equally matched drivers in a driver combination on the same car.
Cars so equally matched as well. You look at GTD, and right now, five different manufacturers in the top five. The BMW in the hands of Madison Snow leading. It's the Lexus in GTD Pro of Jack Hawksworth. The same thing there. Five different manufacturers there representing the five cars that are running, and they're all running incredibly close together. This morning, warm-up, 18 cars within a second.
It's so tight. I mean, the level of competition is ramped up. That's what puts the seasons that the 14 squad are doing in GTD Pro and the one car doing GTD into even more remarkable rarefied air, because you're doing it at where the level of competition is so strong and the competition is so tight. We've got nine manufacturers, nine OEMs involved in this championship this year. It is absolutely enthralling.
I'm gonna drive a Lamborghini around VIR. Let's ride for a second with Laura Spinelli.
You have to have the compliance here with your suspension set up to be able to eat those up, kind of shortcut it, then it's flat out all the way to turn 10 when the car is right.
Up through the climbing S's again on the curbing, and they're using every inch of them, but you don't want to use more because you drop a wheel off the backside. There's absolutely no grip. You're going to go for a ride.
Particularly in this corner. This is turn 11 right there. If you get a little bit wide, you see Mike Skeen there. Perfect line, carving the corner. That left front just gets a little bit wide, gets in what we call the gray, where the dirt is, where the little balls of rubber, the marbles as we call them, as you get a little bit of shaving of the tire going through that particular sector, then you just can't get that left front back. You can't turn it into the corner. You end up in the dust and potentially into the wall.
Look at this, Lexus, Lamborghini, Mercedes AMG, right now in GTD, Tielitz, Spinelli, Skeen. And it's so interesting to me that the cars look so different, different sizes, different shapes, and yet they're able to run so close together, the competition so tight. They make their speed, they make their power in different ways to put those packages together, and they all are so tight. Talk about harder racing. We were talking about Ross Gunn earlier. Track records in 2021 and 2022, they've had some balance of performance adjustments this weekend that have taken some power away from the Aston Martin. And I know they're not pleased with where they're running right now, but we've got a long way to go.
We do, and this is a team that didn't have a podium all season long. Then they've just been on a tear of late. Two poles, two victories in the last two rounds of the championship. There's a late move by Pele. That was pretty risky there on Roman De Angelis, just bought the 27 Heart of Racing machine. That's the sister car to Ross Gunn that you've been talking about, Brian. They are still in the thick of that GTD championship. This Porsche wind up through here. That commitment, having a feather the throttle just a little bit. And you're running that close to a car in front, it's taking the air off the nose, it's taking the air off those little winglets that give you the downforce and push the car into the ground and give you the grip you need.
Well, I was going to say, it's the ultimate trust factor, right? But it's not just trust in your ability through there. but trust in the driver in the car in front of you, because if they have a mistake, you're a part of their bad day.
Well, you're so committed, and the balance of the car is so sensitive, Brian. If you suddenly lift off, that can throw the weight forward in the car, kind of pin the nose and give you a little oversteering moment at super high speed. So, yes, you're right. If the driver in front of you has a moment, you've got to really be on your toes not to fall off the road.
DeAngelis runs in fifth right now in GTD. Just behind him is the pro car you ride with Patrick Pile. And then the third car in that order, I believe, is Patrick Gallagher in the Turner Motorsports BMW, the number 96. And Gallagher has been on fire here this weekend. Very, very quick throughout practice.
He was. He's really starting to learn the ropes of GT3 competition. We talked about Sheena Monk making the transition from GT4 to GT3. Patrick Gallagher aboard the 96 Turner Motorsports BMW. Similar transition, teamed up with Robbie Foley. He's now a gold-rated driver, a pro. He's a BMW factory pilot now. Strong team, but they have not had the season they've been looking for, particularly when you compare it to another BMW team with Paul Miller Racing, who pretty much dominated this season.
Yeah, you kind of scratch your head just a little bit. Things settling down, the racing, though, heating up, and I'm sure the computers on pit lane heating up as well as the engineers, the strategists, try to figure out how do we get our drivers to the front? How do we win here at Virginia International Raceway?
What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
America, come along with our adventure seekers and discover summer with Ford. Join friends Maisa and Leslie on an epic adventure with the capability of the Ford Bronco Sport.
Time for goat mode.
Head out with the Stevens family and stay connected with built-in Wi-Fi in the Ford Explorer.
Did you know that horses sleep standing up?
Road trip with the Sanchez family and available hands-free highway driving in the Ford F-150.
Now cruising.
Scan the QR code to see how Ford can help you discover your best summer ever.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
I watched my first race yesterday.
You're on the team, kid. It's orientation day.
Hey, new guy, let's get you up to speed.
Punch time!
Your workspace is ready.
Looks like you got a corner office.
Be part of something greater. Toyota, let's go places.
But now he hits top gear. Listen to the crowd. What are we witnessing here? It's Noah Lyles defends his world championship.
So USA sweep.
That's dominance by the United States.
Ultimate performance potential.
Battle in earnest going on at Virginia International Raceway and IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Competition. Great shots once again from the WeatherTech aerial coverage as you look down. Danny Yunkadea in the Mercedes, the leading car, the white car there with the white BMW just behind him. That battle is not for position. Yunkadea in the GTD Pro category, and he's got the GTD entry. Madison Snow all over his rear wing, and Yunkadea trying to hunt down that yellow Corvette in front.
Yeah, and it's always an interesting dynamic when you get that overlap between the two classes. Take a look at the Cadillac track facts here, Brian. We talked about it, just over 3.25 miles, 17 turns. Beautiful natural road course. It's really like a resort here. Big elevation change, 131 feet, built back in 1957. They haven't really changed the character of the racetrack. They've just improved the safety elements all the way around. And the first IMSA race was won back in 1971 by Peter Gregg and Hurley Haywood, a couple of legends right there.
As you look down, we were talking about Patrick Gallagher just a little while ago, and a good job he's doing aboard the 96. His teammate's down in pit lane with Hannah.
Yeah, that teammate being Robbie Foley here. And something with these Turner Motorsports BMWs is just firing off well this weekend. Speed and practice. I know Pat felt like he left a little bit out there during qualifying, but nonetheless, the speed is there. So what is working here at VIR for you guys in these BMW?
Yeah, our cars have always loved this track. It's been great for us over the years, going back my tenure with the team. So we had a good race yesterday in our M4 GT4. We're going to try to repeat that luck today. Patrick's doing a great job. He's been really quick this weekend. I think the track temp caught him out a little bit in qualifying, as it did for many. So it ebbs and flows here with the grip and what's available. So we're going to see how the car is in the race. We had a good car in the warm-up. We'll give it a shot.
Robbie Foley, we're going to let him go here because...
And Giocadella currently running in the third position in that number 79 Mercedes. It's certainly been feast or famine this year, winning two of the first four. But since that win at Laguna Seca, their average finish is 4.2. It's pretty much like a heart monitor. Great days, then bad days. The unique season continued, as Calvin mentioned on Friday, with the pit fire. They had to replace the right front fender, also the rocker panel, and the rest was just final. The other thing, and Calvin knows this from being a dad with Libby, when you get glitter involved, you can never get rid of it. Pretty much like the fire extinguisher residue, they have cleaned and cleaned all weekend, and that's still inside that car. But they, too, on a fuel-saving mode. So in about another five laps, pit road could be certainly very busy.
Glitter, the toast at home.
You know it. I've lived it, too.
Well, you talked about a heart monitor, Matt, and I think Denny Yekedea may have needed one, because you said heart monitor, and he did this. Look at the top of the screen.
Yeah, just runs those wheels off on the exit of turn three, so you got to be on your toes. And that's where the experience comes in. Don't pinch the race car. Just try and gradually bring it back on, inch it back onto the road. Don't do any damage. His tail's away looking at it. He is feeling the pressure from behind. Madison Snow says, I'm going to get out of this.
He did try
and challenge the inside of the next corner. He hit the brake pedal. That's what a championship leader needs to do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. He was immediately on it. And we talked about that. Don't be a part of someone's bad day. It can go wrong very quickly here. So you're not only racing your competitors, you're racing the track, I think, as well here, as you're just kind of going, I need to stay focused on me. Race car drivers are good at that, we're selfish.
Not always. But for Madison Snow, they've just been making the right decisions all season long. There you see Aaron Tielitz having a really strong run here today aboard the number 12 Lexus. He's about 3 seconds back of Madison Snow, so that allows Madison to make those decisions. He's not being forced right now by Aaron Tielitz being right on his tail. He sees that moment by Giocadella, and then he can just take his time, let it figure itself out, and then just get back on the program.
Robbie Foley was talking about track temperatures, and I think to a lot of people, even myself, I'm still shocked that minimal changes in track temperature can have such an effect on the way the car handles.
It drives you crazy. You'll come and test at a racetrack. You come back, it's maybe 10 degrees different. It's like, whose race car is this? It's not the one I drove a month ago, but it's just the subtleties of the grip, and it's all about the tire to the road. And if that road changes a little bit, then you've got to adjust the car to get the tire to eat back into it, to grip, to kind of get that grip back underneath you so you can actually commit to the corners once again.
You really kind of see it everywhere. Certainly, if you watch the Indianapolis 500, you know this. The clouds come over, the racetrack gets faster, and I'm excited about us going to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway here in a few weeks in mid-September. That's going to be an awesome, awesome event. Speaking of the Speedway, and did you see Roxy there? I didn't say Rexy, I said Roxy, the pink Porsche. We used to see it a green Porsche, but Roxy is here this weekend, or Rexy is here this weekend, because Roxy is on its way to Japan. Or did I get that back?
I think you got it backwards, but either way, they're brightly colored cars that get a lot of attention. The drivers love driving, and they love the attention that the fans give them. And what's the story on this new livery?
Well, yeah, to correct Brian, you're right. This is Roxy, the pink one, because Rexy is headed over to Japan, but man, they brought out this livery, of course, Roxy being Rexy's sister, and talking to both PJ Hyatt and Seb Priyo, they said, man, the fan interaction that they had with Rexy when they debuted it earlier in the year has been incredible. And Roxy, they even had fans come specifically to this race because they didn't know if Roxy would make it to another race. So they had to come out here, meet Rexy's sister, and man, just the interaction and the investment that fans have come to have with this team. I mean, it's been a great aspect of things. And hey, you know, Seb said, I didn't know that I'd ever drive a hot pink car, let alone one that's a hot pink T-Rex, but here we are. So PJ Hyatt behind the wheel of that Porsche, and man, what a cool interaction it's been to have these guys in the pit area this year.
His kids helped design this scheme on the car, and they put it on, and it is absolutely spectacular. I'm kind of wondering, if you look in your mirror and you see all those teeth, is it intimidating?
But certainly gets your attention. If someone makes a move down the inside, you're going to see them coming. But yeah, I think his son was involved with Rexy. I think his daughter was involved with this livery. So pretty cool. Someone who's taking his game very seriously but having fun at the same time.
You see the little T-Rex arms on the door, too. I think it's absolutely awesome. Talk about awesome. Look at this. Down the back straight, on the way to 14. Snow's got the advantage. He's going to clear the front bumper of the Mercedes. And I'm wondering if Yankadea didn't go, okay, this time I'm not going to fight it that hard.
Yeah, and importantly, Madison got to the right-hand side that gives you the inside for the right-hander that dives you down here. This, I look at this sector like a slalom ski. You got to hit your gates through here. You're like tipping those gates with your tips, hitting your marks. Road just falls away from you. Just huge elevation change. Then you wind it up. So straight away, but a slight kink in there. That gives you the ability to defend that inside lane a little bit. If you're under pressure, but Madison Snow, what about this team? Four wins from the first eight races. They are making history here this year.
Snow has cleared Yankadea, now trying to get as far away as he can from Aaron Tielitz. You talked about snow skiing. I want to go snow skiing with you. I want to see that. I want to see the yard sale down the hill. No yard sale here at BIR. Race well underway. Lexus out in front, and they stay there till the end.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years, but VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your streetcar, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute with our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
Michelin keeps innovating so the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
Hey, stop.
Found it.
Can I get a ruling?
Don't beg.
It's unbecoming.
Is that good? I can't tell.
There's no such thing as out of bounds. Find adventure at the Lexus Golden Opportunity sales event.
Goikberg behind the wheel now of the number 78 Lamborghini that Laura Spinelli took the green flag in, just came to pit road, but they had some type of a interesting problem on the way into the pit lane. We were coming to the end of minimum drive time, and Calvin, I looked at you, and you're like, did he have a mechanical problem, or was he going to be short on his drive times? Did he just stop?
No, I think he's still shy. He came in and hit pit lane. He was about 6 seconds shy of that, so that was not a strategy there. There must have been some kind of technical issue. I'm not sure whether it was when he was hitting the pit lane speed limiter button. But either way, our GTD championship leader is in. You have to do this. You have to protect in case you get a four-course yellow. You lose all that track position. So they can do a driver change now and elect to go two ways. Double stint with Brian Sellers or get Madison going back in. Matt?
Exactly the game plan here on the one BMW. And Calvin, like you talked about, they've gone past that threshold, so they've hit the 45-minute mark. So now driver times, they are checking that off the box. Meanwhile, you're going to see more and more cars, Hannah. You're in the BMW. I'm down here in Lexus. They're up on the wall.
Yeah, Matt, the BMW is in as well for Turner Motorsports. We saw Pat Gallagher got out of the 96. Robbie Foley went and jumped in, and of course Chandler Hull qualified the other teammate car, the 97. Chandler Hull jumped out, Bill Oberlin, and also a busy time down here in GT Pits. There you can see it there, the 66. Grady at Acura, Sheena Monk out, and Catherine Legg behind the wheel now.
There is so much that's going on in the pit stop in addition to the fuel and the tires going on. The driver change, it's complicated. You don't just get in and pull the seatbelt over like you do in your passenger car. A lot of buttons to push, reset fuel, get your radio in. It is busy. It's busy coming out of the pit lane as well.
There's a bump there. Bill Oberlin trying to take advantage of relatively cold tires there. Get around the outside of Catherine Legg. There's a little touch. He keeps it together and gains that position immediately. There's the experience going to work. Catherine won't like that one.
I was going to say, as soon as you're out of pit lane, it's go time. And he just caught Catherine Legg sleeping just a little bit. Hannah, the 78, you've got an answer for us?
Yeah, you guys were talking about it. We didn't know if it was a drive time situation or what it was, but the car completely lost power coming to pit road, had to stop, power cycle it, and then brought it back down here. So that's something this team over here is looking at data and still trying to establish what the possible problem could have been. But right now, it's heads down, new tires, and all things forward for Goikberg behind the wheel of that car.
On board now with Misha Goikberg. Goikberg struggling to get his belts tight before he got on the racetrack. That's why you never really want to carry the onboard camera, right?
Yeah.
Like, but he got him done, got him up on his Hans device, and got him tightened as he was leaving pit lane. But talk about what a busy time it is. There's a lot to get done in a short amount of time.
This is a team that's really come on form of late. Team Kordoff Motorsports, Mercedes, Mike Skeen, Michael Grenier, had two podium runs in the last three races. After a hot start last year with Stephen Mackler and Mike Skeen, were the championship leaders for quite some time. They kind of petered off at the end of last year. I think they've learned a lot, continued to grow as a relatively young team in our sport.
Well, yeah, they had a pole position at Lime Rock Park as well, so the performance is certainly there. You just have to get all of the pieces of the recipe together in order to bake the cake the way that you want it to be, and I think they're working on refining that recipe.
You talk about undercut potential there. I think the Turner Motorsport team may have gained a little bit of track position there by pitting Robbie Foley, or getting Robbie Foley in for Patrick Gallagher a little bit earlier than the Heart of Racing Aston Martin.
Talk about another team that has been very, very quick this year, but has not had the results that they would want. That's Inception Racing, right on board the McLaren right now. Brendan Reeve behind the wheel. I mean, they have been rocket ship fast.
Oh, really quick. We talked about two podiums in the last three races for Team Kordoff. This team has done the same thing, but it's been two runner-up finishes. They did win on the road last year at Mid-Ohio, but lost that in post-race tech. Here comes Aaron Tielitz, the number 12 car, one of the front-running cars in GTD. Nice, solid run by Aaron here today.
This is one of those GTD pairings, Calvin, where you talk about the delta between the drivers. It's very close. Frankie Montecalvo is very, very quick to the marks. Matt?
And Montecalvo off the wall, opens the door, driver change going on. Not a lot of comments about the balance of this car. Tielitz had made it up to the lead before he hit pit road. This team would love to have a day like they did at Watkins Glen, where both GTD Pro and GTD Trophies went home with Vassar Sullivan waiting on the fuel. 21 seconds, 22 seconds. It seems like eternity as Dusty's waiting to get the clear, and now he's away.
Full fuel load on these machines is 40 seconds, but because we're stopping shy of an hour, that means they don't need a full top. They'll top it up, but the fuel tank is not empty, so it takes less time.
Which is why it's such a busy time for that driver change. When you don't do the full stint, you don't have nearly as much time
to get your job done and get everything sorted the way that you need to. It becomes very, very hairy.
Such orchestration involved in those driver changes, and it all goes well and smooth, but as soon as it goes a little bit sideways, like my airline travel, Brian, it gets really ugly in a hurry.
I don't want to travel with you anywhere.
But it can. You suddenly sit on a seatbelt, something goes wrong, and then you panic a little bit, and you just can't get that time back.
In some regards, it's like driving the race car. If you make a mistake, you have to put it behind you. You can't concentrate on the mistake that you made. Forget it, get it righted, get it sorted, and get back out on the racetrack. Jack Hawksworth continues to lead on board the number 14. Antonio Garcia right there behind him in GTD Pro. Ryan Sellers now behind the wheel of the number one. Where is it? In the number one position. They have had a magical year. You pointed to that early on.
And he's 3 seconds to the good right now on the 12 machine, but Robbie Foley has got good track position. They've moved that Turner Motorsport car up from about sixth position in class up to P3 right now. So that would have taken a really good in-lap by Patrick Gallagher, a smart pit stop, and a good out-lap. As important, when you get out there on those relatively cold tires, that's when the driver can make the difference, take a little bit more risk, as we see the 23 car going for 3 straight victories this season, making their first pit stop of the day.
Alex Riberas getting in. Understand there'll be a penalty for the 27. Failure to adhere to the minimum full refueling time. And we've seen this penalty handed down quite a bit this year. There's a flow rate that needs to be adhered to. You can't fuel too quickly, and it's measured. I don't know how, but it's measured.
Well, the equipment is there to do the monitoring, and it's not, you can't just say, oh, you got to be standstill for 40 seconds every time, because the fuel tank is typically not empty, but they check the fuel flow rate. They'll analyze how much fuel went on board, how long did it take. If those two numbers don't match, guess what? You're going to get dinged and drive through penalty here. Cost you about 21 seconds to the field under green.
So when you think about Marco Sorensen as well, in this Aston Martin, I looked at the list, and I don't know if he's on it. I'll look back one more time. I counted 17 rookies, not necessarily to this racetrack, but to GTD competition at this racetrack. It's great that you know it, and it gives you an advantage, but if you've only driven a GT4-based car before here, and now you're in a GT3 car, or you've been in a single-make series, this is a big jump up to the GT3 machinery of the WeatherTech Championship.
It is, and for Sorensen, he didn't know many of the racetracks coming into this season, so that's a compromise. 3 cars in pit lane. Matty?
And Michelin Tires getting ready to go on here, this number 3 Corvette. Looking ahead to the future with the new car, but trying to stay focused on the current plan, and that's winning out the rest of the season if possible, especially at Petit Le Mans. Antonio Garcia's never won there. It seems like Corvette hasn't won there forever, almost over 15 years. Out this chapter with a win, but they too were playing more of the fuel mileage game, knowing the pace that they have. Meanwhile, here in Vassar Sullivan Lexus, the guys are up on the wall waiting for Hawksworth to bring that 14 to pit lane for service.
Yeah, they have to respond, because with this undercut that they've done with the Corvette, they can't afford to play with that margin that they had too much with our leader, Hawksworth. You'd have to think he'll be in next time around.
Shandorf now behind the wheel of the 70 Inception McLaren. He's got the number 9 Porsche, Klaus Bockler, behind the wheel of that car now. And Shandorf is a rocket in this McLaren as well, and he's trying to get by the Porsche. It looks like he might have the quicker car. He's going to force the issue.
A brave move there. It's really tight. Awesome action here through turn 3. Shandorf up on the wheel, looking for opportunity.
Bockler just closed the door there.
You talk to everyone in this paddock, and they said it's only a matter of time before this McLaren breaks through and grabs a win.
Hawksworth now on pit lane. It seems like it takes forever to get to the end of pit lane where the Vassar Sullivan team is, but Hawksworth slides to the marks. Here we go, Matty.
And service going on. You can see Hawksworth getting out. Ben Barnico getting in. Travis Morgan, the front changer. Solid service there. Bosey indexing that left rear on this 14 machine. The Michelin tires on, signaling that we're ready to go. Now just waiting on that VP fuel. This team would love to have a closeout like they did last year, going first, third, and first in those final 3. Still waiting on fuel. The VP forever in. He's gone.
you can tell the difference. Hawksworth on the racetrack longer. It took longer to fuel it because it needed more fuel. More had been burned.
Shando makes his way around Pillay. Now he's going to go on the attack. I think Jordan Taylor's going to be relatively close to Ben Barnico with that undercut that the Corvette did. So this next lap will be important. Barnico will still have the track position, but for the three car, they've got to try and get up on the wheel here.
Back out, and it will cycle through. We'll figure out who's in front, but right now, Brian Sellers having a great run in GTD, leading in the number one from VIR and Simpson WeatherTech Sports Car Championship, GT only.
So the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
America, come along with our adventure seekers and discover summer with Ford. Join friends Maisa and Leslie on an epic adventure with the capability of the Ford Bronco Sport.
Time for goat mode.
Head out with the Stevens family and stay connected with built-in Wi-Fi in the Ford Explorer.
Did you know that horses sleep standing up?
Road trip with the Sanchez family and available hands-free highway driving in the Ford F-150.
Now cruising.
Scan the QR code to see how Ford can help you discover your best summer ever.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years, but VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your streetcar, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute with our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
Give your vehicle a real power boost with VP Octanium Octane Booster and keep your engine running cooler with VP Cooldown. Put the thrill back into driving. Find VP Racing products at your local auto parts store. Right on board with Bill Oberlin, winningest driver in IMSA history, and down the front straightaway here. And BMW is running so well in fact, there's a GTD car leading overall here. It's Brian Sellers on board that Paul Miller Racing BMW. We talk about the season that they've had, and I guess, Calvin, if you could list out exactly how they've done it and how that team has gelled and you knew all the ingredients, you could sell it and make a fortune, right? But it is a mixture of everything, right?
Well, they've just got a great crew. They got this car late to start the 2022 season. They missed Daytona. But they had a really strong season outside of that. But they come back with a lot of knowledge with this race car, and they're just putting it to work. And what you're seeing here is what was a five-lap undercut. We talked about that as one of the WeatherTech keys to victory. By pitting Madison Snow five laps earlier than Jack Hawksworth coming in, you can see what it's done. It's now put our GTD leader in front of the GTD Pro leader, is Ben Barnico. Barnico's got a little bit more pace right now. Oh, that's Goikberg off.
That's turn one easy to do. It's kind of like that turn 11 and 12 complex. You get out there a little bit high, and you drop the left side wheel off, and you're going for a ride.
Talk about the challenges here at VIR. Takes big commitment. You're coming down from about 165 miles an hour to about 60 miles an hour minimum speed in turn one. And if you get outside that line, you don't keep between heaven's gates, as we said, you're going to go for a bit of a ride.
This car's been off the racetrack a lot in practice this weekend. It's like they've had a hard time getting a handle on it, and there you go.
Well, that's a problem, because these cars have ABS, yeah. And he didn't have any right there. So I think there may have been some kind of electronic failure here. Let's take a listen.
Yeah, that's odd.
Yeah, essentially what should happen there, the brake pressure should go away to keep the tire moving. You're going to lose braking ability, but you shouldn't hear the tires lock up like that, Hannah.
Don't try that.
And that 78 team going to go ahead and call their driver down here to pit road. But this is, you guys had mentioned it, it's been an ongoing issue for this team all weekend long. They had power outages issues in both practice sessions. We just saw it as far as coming down into pit entry. And they said ABS is no longer working. So they're going to call him down here on pit road and going to head no fuel and take a look and see what they can establish down here on pit road.
I think the other problem, the reason they need to get him in, Calvin, when he left, I saw some of those air intakes packed with grass. I think they do such a great job here at VIR of keeping the racetrack manicured, but you get some rain, you can't mow it for a few days, kind of like my yard at home, right? And it gets tall. The next time you mow it, there's gonna be some clippings out there. And he picked up a bunch of them in a big, big incident. That's turn 14, the end of the straightaway. I can't see the car involved, but heavy impact with the tire barrier there. Car on the other side of those tires, and I can't
see
who
it is. I think it's the 78. He's got big braking issues. That's caught him out again, just trying to get the car back to pit lane. High speed again. Both areas of the racetrack where he's had problems. You're coming from 165 miles an hour terminal speed, trying to get the speed arrested. And he obviously had a big, well, I assume he had another lock up there going into that brake zone.
And you're, it's kind of one of those deals where you're damned if you do and damned if you don't. You need to hurry to get back to the pit lane, but at the same point in time, you've got a car that has a problem. Here's a look. Car goes by. Then you hear it.
Let's go on board with him and see what Misha was feeling or seeing.
Same issue. It's got to be front brakes because the car doesn't turn.
Well, there's no ABS working, so the system and all of the pressures and the master cylinder, everything are geared around the ABS working, so he's needing that amount of brake pressure, and normally the ABS is kicking in, and it's just not working.
Misha Koichberg with the big hit there. Those tire bundles, they have the banding on them. It keeps them together, and they do a great job of absorbing the energy. They're actually away from the guardrails themselves, so you can move the entire section of tires with your impact. That's good news for the drivers and teams because some of that energy is absorbed by those tires. Bad news, though, because this cleanup will take a while. While they go to work in the AMR safety team there tending to the stricken number 78, we'll take a quick break from VIR. We'll be back to more IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Series action from VIR. Welcome back to Virginia International Raceway. As you look down on a very crowded paddock and spectator parking area, because you want to come to this racetrack. If you've never been here, put it on your calendar for 2024. IMSA will be back, and you can come and watch some great GT racing at one of the nation's finest racetracks. We've seen some raindrops, dare I say it, Calvin, on some of the windshields of these cars, just something else to spice things up.
I know, and we talked about the season that the two championship leading cars are having. They started from the pole, they lead this race still, but these are all the little variables they got to deal with. These yellows, the timing of the yellows, if there's any weather that suddenly comes your way. So you cannot relax. I mean, this sport just keeps you on your toes right till the checkered flag.
You can see some rain coming down there a little bit heavier, so I'll have to check the radar here in just a second, but you talk about the challenges here at VIR. You know what's challenging? Right down the street. I should say right down the street, but not too far away. Martinsville. You ever been to Martinsville?
No.
You should go there, the little half-mile paperclip, as they call it. You should go there because the guys in Mazda MX-5 Cup did for a test here recently, and people are going, well, this is raising some eyebrows, and it wasn't just anybody that ran there. Clay Campbell, who's the president of Martinsville Speedway, was there. There's Clay. And a couple of drivers in the NASCAR Hall of Fame, Bobby Labonte and one Dale Earnhardt Jr.
It would be tempting to want to come race. You know, if they had a race here, it'd be very tempting for me and a lot of other people, especially oval racers, to come be a part of the series if they were to come to Martinsville. All the IMSA fans and the NASCAR fans coming together to watch this, that's what would happen. So it'd probably be pretty fantastic for the series. And you could literally see a world where people can go through the IMSA ladder and choose to race sports cars, prototypes, and race in the Cup Series in the next gen car, because they're much more similar today than they've ever been. What NASCAR would love to do is the Mazda MX-5 Series to be another complement to its brand and provide more opportunities for drivers.
I think that's just awesome. And you think about the single make series that IMSA has, and you think about the history of John Doonan. Well, he was at Mazda for a long time. I'm sure he's smiling a little bit to see that. And Chad McCombie was there from McCombie McAleer Racing, who played Dale Earnhardt in one of the movies that was on ESPN, the we'll call it Movie 3. And you think about that, and I think it would be really, really cool. And to hear Junior go, I'd like to come race that. I think that would be fun.
Well, we saw our mate Hinch, James Hinchcliffe, do one of the races earlier this year. Had a blast. I mean, Parker Kligerman's been out there. I mean, the race is just simply fantastic. I mean, the battles that they... No. It's not going to happen.
Not going to happen. I want to take you skiing, and I want to see you in a Cup car.
Well, I'd probably be better in the Cup car than I would on skis. That's a little sketchy, actually.
Hannah?
And standing here on pit road with Sheena Monk, of course, Catherine Legg behind the wheel of your Acura out there. We talked earlier in the day, and you said your first couple laps here on this racetrack, a little daunting, but a great first stint there for you. What's your kind of your evaluation of that Acura, and what has Catherine got behind her?
I mean, the biggest takeaway I can say is just this heat is staggering. You know, it's like I equate it to kind of like opening your oven and just standing there and taking that all in, but kind of wearing a snowsuit all at the same time. So it's really tough. But, you know, the Acura, we were struggling a bit with some understeer, and so it was kind of just driving through that and figuring out what the car wanted just in order to get a good drive off of the slower corners for us, so we were kind of working around that.
Yeah, let's talk about the physicality aspect of that heat. It's been hot all weekend long. We got some cloud coverage, and it's actually spitting on us a little bit right now, but nonetheless, the physicality behind the wheel, how do you guys manage that?
Yeah, I actually I got some ice bags that I've been keeping with me. You know, when I got out of the car, threw an ice cold rag on the back of my neck. It's really tough in there. You're working super hard, but like there's almost nothing that can prepare you for the heat. You know, you can do the best training wise, but it's a struggle. So, you know, we're working around that. Kat's super fit. So I think, you know, I feel bad for her that she's got to do 2 hours in the car. I only had to do about an hour. So, you know, we'll see how it goes. The rain actually could play into our hands if the weather gets a little bit worse. Our Acura, our J.G. Wentworth Acura NSX GT3 Evo 22 is really good in the wet. I haven't even had a chance to drive it in the wet, but, you know, with Kat behind the wheel, I'm sure it could play into our hands.
It's definitely a toss-up down here on pit road for some of the teams that want to see the rain and some of them that want it to stay away, Matt.
And, Hannah, when you look at the umbrellas, part of it for rain, but also part of it for sun, and that's the one thing about technology in racing, and especially here on pit road. We showed you over our NBC coverage this weekend about how some drivers and crew members were wearing the Sparco Cool vest, which worked for about an hour and a half to hour 45 minutes. And for Jack Hawksworth, you've got an entire system set inside that when you sit inside the car, hoses and everything. Walk us through how you try to keep the core cool during a warm day.
Yeah, it's basically like the opposite of a radiator. You know, it pumps cold water around a set of tubes, which you can kind of just see there, and when it's working well, which it was then, it just keeps your core temperature down. Humid, hot day like this is perfect, really.
Going according to game plan, you always sit down the weekend and say, all right, this is where we would like to be at this juncture of the event. Everything going according to plan so far?
I mean, we've had a good race so far. We've been out front all the time, so you can't complain with that. Car's been on rails. Boys have done a mega job all weekend. So, yeah, we'll see. Obviously now, thunderstorms and whatnot are in the area, so who knows when this thing's going to go red flag or when the next yellow's going to come, but see what happens. But yeah, in the dry we feel good.
Thanks, Jack. When you look at this weekend, really it goes all the way back to 2019 when our teammate Townsend Bell was at Lime Rock, and he and Jack
just considerable day of heat, excruciating. Both had to go to the infield care center when the day was over to get IVs. And so the team, Greg Cates, the team manager, and Sully Sullivan, they told everyone about a week out, start hydrating, whether you're an over-the-wall guy, on the box, or a driver. You've got to build up your hydration when we get to this hot weekend, both Friday and Saturday, because we need to have you mentally there to be able to perform your task perfectly on Sunday.
Well, I see some showers on the radar just south of there, but they're very small in size. There's some bigger ones about 60 miles to the southwest, but we'll have to see if they get there. There's the damage to the 78 and extensive, but it could have been a lot worse. That tire wall did exactly what it was supposed to do, so good news there. And I know they're talking about rain and a little bit of drizzle coming down, but rain tires at the ready, I understand why they would be, but I certainly wouldn't put them on a car right now.
No, not yet. The conditions would not be good, because with those tread blocks, it dissipates the water, but they move around and overheat really quickly. It's a much softer compound than we run here with the slick Michelin.
There was a picture of Calvin during the last break. He was taking a little bit of a nap, but he'll wake up with the engines fire back up, and we go back racing at VIR. There it is, just in time. Green flag waves racing again at VIR after the heavy impact that Misha Goikberg had aboard his number 78 Lamborghini at the end of the back straight, turn 14. He was checked at the infield medical center and released. So that is great, great news. His Lamborghini, not nearly as fortunate. Significant damage to that car as we're back under green.
Bright orange car there in the middle of our pitch right now. Shandoff just made a move on Frankie Montecarlo on the restart. Gets up to P3 in GTD. And where the potential of that car, Brian, is knocking on the door for a win.
Well, I was going to say, and immediately then right on the rear wing of the BMW in front of him. So really, really quick to get up to speed, comfortable in that car. Robbie Foley aboard that bright yellow and blue BMW, the 96. He's got a rearview mirror right now full of a McLaren that is on a charge.
Yeah, Foley's on the charge, though. They do a lot of testing here with the Turner Motorsport team. He sat a similar car on the pole in SRO competition earlier this season. So he loves this racetrack, and they need a result. Right there, looked like Shando was having a look to the inside of Foley going through Oaktree.
Montecarlo not able to keep up with the pace. You can see the distance there. The McLaren streaking by camera right, and then Montecarlo in this battle a little further back. Cars trying to move forward.
And Kai Van Berlo aboard the number 91 side by side with Sorensen trying to intimidate him. Here comes Sorensen with a run, but Van Berlo's going to send it, I believe, into the brake zone. This is where it's tight, they touch.
How nervous you get driving on the road when somebody kind of creeps over towards your lane a little bit. Those cars inches apart, about 160 miles an hour into the brake zone.
Yeah, that is wild stuff. You can't intimidate that young Dutchman. He's going to go for it. He's going to get his elbows out. He's out here to make an impression. And you got the similar car, Cipriano with AO Racing. Roxy, the bright pink car, now making a move on Sorensen as well.
We talked about this earlier, Sorensen, a lot of these racetracks so new to him. And VIR is one of those, and it has its intricacies. You've got to have experience here to know how to wring everything out of it. Otherwise, you're going to get bit.
Bit of a split strategy. So the top nine in the race haven't pitted for like 14 laps, and everyone else behind them, like the second half of the field, they're topped up with fuel. So that's going to come into play a little bit deeper into this race today. Look out for that.
See there on screen left, laps since the last pit stop. Zeller's one of those that it has been a while, 14 laps since he was in. That was making that undercut that you talked about earlier, Calvin.
Everyone's going to need one more stop. It's just in the second half of the field. That stop for field will be a lot lighter. Here's two from the overall lead, Barnacle to the inside. But that gives Jordan Taylor a run here. Aboard the number three, he's got to make something happen. That's the championship leader he's chasing, the race leader. The Corvette has to make something happen here today to try and cut into that championship lead. He gets to the right side. This is perfect.
Right where he wants to be. Barnacle not able to defend yet, but then later on the brakes, the Taylor is. Can he get it slowed down? Can he make the corner? He does.
What a job that Ben Barnacle did there under braking. He's on the grippier side of the racetrack, admittedly. But that was really brave.
Up and over the curbs as they come down through the roller coaster. Taylor on the charge, trying to get back up front, looking for another win on the season. He and Antonio Garcia have won at CTMP. They didn't think they had the speed there to get it done. They did walk out of Canada with the big trophy. They'd love to do it here.
We talked about this at the top of the show, Brian. These championship leaders, as in Barnico, who leads this race right now, have a target on their back. The three team, they're disgruntled. They don't like the performance they had this year. They want to go out on a high. Jordan Taylor's made an announcement. He's moving over to GTP competition, returning to Wayne Taylor Racing, his father's team, and associated with Andretti Autosport. Going to be a shake-up with the Corvette driver lineup for next year. He wants to go out on a high now.
Well, I would think the level of professionalism that these drivers have, you're able to put away the distraction of the future and concentrate on the now. That's exactly what Jordan Taylor trying to do right now. But outside the car, I would think that that is somewhat of a distraction.
It can be, but I mean, Jordan's got so much experience. He knows there's an outside chance at the championship, and they've got to take points away from the car in front of him. They can't afford to lose more ground. There's an outside possibility that the 14 could clinch here today if they score a victory and the Corvette finishes in like fourth or fifth on the road.
Got to keep it going. Got to keep it going, and I'm sure that's the message that's on the radio. Keep this championship alive. And you talk about it. The opposite of that for Ben Barnico, for Jack Hawksworth, is that Corvette behind you is willing to do anything to finish in front of you, and that anything could put you out of the event.
Exactly. I mean, Jordan Taylor's a really clean driver. He'll put it right on the line, but that was really just showcasing the confidence that Ben Barnico has on that 14 machine to take it that deep on the brakes, basically gain a car length, and then turn into the corner. Matt?
And Calvin, they were looking at a possible different change in strategy, a double audible, so to speak. They were going to pit, take left side tires under that last caution to get a little bit more off sequence to see if they could make that more to their advantage. Then they said, nope, let's audible again. Let's just do what the 14, what the Vassar, Sullivan, Lexus does. They stayed out, so the three Corvettes stayed out as well.
We talk about audibles, and I'll put it in football terms. Calvin, who makes the ultimate decision? Obviously, the crew has to call you in, but how involved is the driver with some of those calls, or are they just focused on driving the car?
Well, the driver can give you the feedback about how competitive we are. Can we go after that Lexus versus needing strategies to do it? Here's the run. Sellers there was leading overall. Barnico goes to the inside. Jordan Taylor gets the run, and then importantly, right here, he gets to the right-hand side. That's exactly where you want to be, so you got that little jig to the left. He's on the dirty part of the racetrack. Barnacle's on the clean part, and he just takes it in super deep. You can see the black rubber that he's on top of. His Sellers getting a little bit wide through 11 and 12. Keeps it together, but then everyone else getting runs on him.
And when Barco slides over like this, I think Jordan Taylor wants to stay in his draft. He moves over, almost makes contact with Sellers. End up three of them nose to tail, and then pops driver's right, trying to get the job done. But it's the braking by Barnico that I thought was spectacular.
Right there, just so impressive. But that comes from the season that they put together, the fact that they're in sync with that race car, they got it working well. They continue to put numbers on the board. Little lockup there.
That's not lockup, it's still there. That's
oh, the
tire
damage. I thought that was a lockup in the rear. It's actually the bodywork, so he's had a little punt from someone.
Just folded in, they're gonna have to take care of that tire. Let's see how it happens.
It's turn three.
That was
super aggressive there.
Remember, he's not been here, so learning the nuances of this racetrack, but that is going to be a big-time problem. I don't think that Michelin tire, they are durable and they last, but they don't last when carbon fiber is rubbing up against them. And the problem is, for the 79, Hunon should have hit pit lane if they had known the extent of the damage. He could have dove to pit lane right there as he came by. Now it's 3 and 4 miles around.
Yeah, it's going to be a problem unless that piece of diffuser kind of goes away and takes away the potential of cutting down that tire. You do not want to cut a tire down heading up through these high-speed S's.
And that incident is under review, so the officials are going to look at that contact between the 9 and the 79. And I think a lot of it will have to do with what happens here. If there was no damage, penalty may have been one thing, but if it's damaged and you've just ruined their race and they've got to come to pit lane, officials may take a different view of it.
It's not into the more vulnerable part of the tire, the sidewall, but it's actually into the meat, like the tread of the tire. But even so, it's continuing to rub. It's got to be getting down to the cord here pretty quickly.
Question is, how much damage does Bachler have? Obviously, the right front fender is loose, and at 160 miles an hour, you wonder if it's going to pack air up underneath it, or is the air going to force it back down to where it needs to be? Being told no action on that incident.
Let's go racing, boys. Letting them rough today.
I'm going to say, I turned and looked at you when I read that, and I saw your head shaking. I don't think if you were reading something in front of you, I think you were going, I'm not sure I agree.
Well, I think Bachler just misjudged it. He just almost ran over the Mercedes there, so, you know, and the Mercedes lost the position and has some damage as well, so. But long as the calls are consistent, and that's what we like to see with the IMSA race director and the stewards out there, they've made a really good job of keeping the calls consistent.
We'll go break, and we'll go nonstop as well as Ben Barnico sliding that Lexus around VIR in the lead here in the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years, but VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your street car, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute with our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
Michelin keeps innovating so the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life. What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
It's orientation day. Welcome to the team.
Who wants to race?
I like this team.
Be part of something greater. Toyota, let's go places.
But now he hits top gear. Listen to the crowd. What are we witnessing here? It's Noah Lyles defends his world championship.
It's a USA sweep. That's dominance by the United States.
Racing certainly exciting, and sometimes it can be downright horrifying. This is last night, Daytona International Speedway, NASCAR Cup action. Ryan Preece aboard his number 41 Stewart Haas entry. As soon as it gets in the grass, it gets just enough air underneath it, Calvin, to launch at these cars of 190 plus miles an hour. Absolutely terrifying incident.
Just incredible that you can have an incident like that and walk away. Just amazing the strength, safety measures that have been built into this next gen car.
Yeah, he climbs out, gets on the stretcher as he's told to do, but he was released and from Halifax Health Center early this morning following that accident last night. That is great news. I know for his wife Heather, who was at home watching that, she had to be absolutely horrified by that, but it just shows the strength and the safety in this next gen car. And hats off to the designers of all of that. That is absolutely fantastic news to see him go get away. And then next weekend, hey, it's the start of the championship at Darlington. The Lady in Black, the track Too Tough to Tame, whatever you want to call it. The playoffs start next Sunday, 6 Eastern time. Paperclip. I mean, it's wild there. It is absolutely wild. This is what the playoffs look like. Settled last night. Now it's round one of 16 starting there at Darlington. Bubba Wallace in with the win last night. Chase Elliott, where is he? Well, he's not there.
Yeah, that's a big surprise. I mean, with the speed of that team and Chase not making the cut. Michael McDowell, what a story that's been this year. Just great to see him have an opportunity in the Chase standings.
September 3rd, 6 p.m., 367 laps around that racetrack. Some people are going to end up with the Darlington stripe for sure. I got a feeling there that one's going to be worth watching. This is worth watching as Jordan Taylor trying to do everything he can aboard that bright yellow number 3 Corvette. They want to go out of this factory Corvette program as winners, and they'd love to do it with a championship win, a win at Petit Le Mans, a win any and everywhere along the way. They've just been stymied this year. Only that one victory, going to a Pratt & Miller run, more privateer kind of organization away from the factory Corvette moniker next year. We'll still see the Corvette out there, that new GT3 car. We'll also see it in the hands of privateers. That's good news. Like I said, you always want to go out a winner, and they're going to do everything they can to get that done.
Seeing here, they're obviously taking off from the pack here a little bit, but deep in this pack, you've got Klaus Backler. We pitted some 6 laps deeper into this race than these two leaders. Now, he doesn't have great track position right now, but I've got a feeling once we get into the pit stop window where you can stop and make it to the end on fuel, that may force the hand of these two leaders, Brian, because if you get a yellow and Backler comes in with you, his pit stop is going to be much, much quicker.
Yep, absolutely. And you look at GTD, Robbie Foley having a great run aboard the 96. Sellers in a BMW out front. What are they saying down in the Turner camp, Anna?
Yeah, well, Brian, not only the 96 Turner BMW having a good run, but so is the 97. So Pat Gallagher sitting here watching your teammate of Robbie Foley. When we talked earlier on the weekend, your car was kind of the front runner between the two BMWs. But one of the things that you said is this is maybe two cars, but a one team effort. What's been the collaborative effort to have both of these BMWs running in the top 5 right now?
Yeah, certainly, Anna. We Turner Motorsports, it's, you know, two cars, one team. We share all the notes and setup, and, you know, the four of us drivers work together so that we can all be better. We're both in the top 4 right here, so we got 2 good BMWs. We'll see, you know, Robbie, obviously we want the yellow one to do better, but we'd like those guys to finish second. It's kind of the mentality, right? If, you know, the better each of us are is just going to push the other one. And, you know, we're in the hunt here. I don't know if we have the speed of that McLaren. He kind of fired off really strong and then seemed to just kind of chill out. So we'll see. Robbie's running good and, you know, just really, really happy with the first stint saving fuel and kind of jumping some guys in the pit stop. So, you know, the Belhaven Investments, Turner Motorsports, Lukumali BMW, on for a podium maybe. We'll see.
All in all, a good day so far for the Turner Motorsports BMW, Matt.
Very solid day for the 9. The plaid Porsche currently runs in the 3rd position. Now, Steve Bortolotti, the team manager, informed Backler, no action by IMSA. Track position is crucial at this point. They told him a few moments ago, our window opens in about 3 laps. Go aggressive, go as hard as you can. You are doing fantastic. Hannah.
Well, Matt, one of the drivers somewhat new to the WeatherTech field, specifically in GTD this weekend, is that 91 of Kai Van Bertelo. And of course, that team as a whole, the 92 and the 91 Porsche machines with Kelly Moss and Riley Motorsports, making that jump up here to GT. And one of the things that, you know, I talked to Kai Van Bertelo, he said, man, this year as a whole has been absolutely incredible. Of course, the whole aspect of the team is new. You took 2 brand new drivers of himself and Alan Metney. They have a new car here with the Porsche. And then, of course, bringing Kelly Moss here into the WeatherTech side of the paddock has been a learning experience for the whole team. But the goal this year was to build a platform, build that foundation in which they feel they can build on for next year. That's exactly what they've done in their rookie year so far. They went ahead and already got that win over at Laguna earlier on this year. So that right there, they said, exceeded their expectations. But something Kai told me, he said, you know, I'm sure everyone else is against it, but I would love some rain here this afternoon. He loves wet weather racing. He said a scenario like that would really put his 91 Porsche team here in the hunt this afternoon.
Well, he may get his wish. There's showers around the area. I don't know how big a factor they're going to play, but I think about what Hannah was saying, growth of that team, other teams coming in. And I don't want this season to end, but when you look forward to 2024, some of the changes that are coming, new teams coming in, Calvin, next year may even be even better.
Yeah, and I think for these teams on their debut season, they're then going to have that notebook to work from, they'll have the experience, they'll come back even stronger. So it's been fun to watch Kai Van Berlo. He had a great little battle about 5 minutes ago with Seb Prio, someone who he battled very hard for the 2021 Porsche GT3 Cup Championship here in North America. So great to see those two young superstars going head-to-head here today.
Up through the climbing S's they go, flat out till you get to turn 10. Absolutely awesome stuff. Pit stops should be just around the corner from here at VIR. We'll make sure we catch them for you when we come back. Stay with us.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
Michelin keeps innovating so the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years, but VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your street car, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute with our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
Hey, stop, stop, stop.
Found it.
Can I get a ruling?
Don't beg.
It's unbecoming.
Is that good? I can't tell.
There's no such thing as out of bounds. Find adventure at the Lexus Golden Opportunity sales event.
Saturday, college football is on NBC and Peacock. First up, only on Peacock, it's Michigan's home opener from the Big House. Then on NBC and Peacock, the Fighting Irish look to take care of business at their home opener in South Bend. And in prime time, it's the premiere of Big Ten Saturday Night with West Virginia, Penn State from Happy Valley. Saturday on NBC and Peacock.
96 on pit road, and I'll expect to see more cars coming your way, Hannah.
Yeah, brand new Michelin tires going on that BMW, as well as VP Racing Fuel. Of course, you've got Roby Foley behind the wheel still staying in there, getting that full fuel load. This should be the last time we see this BMW come down here in pit road. So away goes Roby Foley. And man, again, we talked about it. They've just had a good run overall here. But something interesting, the 96 just came down pit road. They're going to hold the 97 of Oberlin for one more lap to put these two on different pit strategies, guys.
An hour to go, Calvin. Can you make it?
Yeah, I think 70 minutes was the max you could go. Running pretty lean, so you're right in that window. You're not giving up too much lap time to be able to get to the finish. You've got to be mindful. You can't go full bore. You're looking at about 57 minutes full rich, so they're right on that number. So they should be good to go, and they're having a really strong day. This typically will create a little bit of a domino effect with cars in your class following suit and hitting pit lane.
See the leaderboard on the left and moving right now, trying to move up the order. The number 12, Aaron Tielitz, climbing back on board.
Double driver change. Yep. They were elected to qualify their pro in the car, Aaron Tielitz. Let Frankie Montecarlo do his stint in the middle and then put Aaron back in. Again, there's a little bit of risk there. Anytime you're doing a driver change, it can go wrong, particularly if you're not putting a full fuel load on and giving those drivers 40 seconds to work with. With a shorter refill time,
the tank not fully empty. That puts the pressure on the drivers.
They're your Lexus biggest movers. I said Thielen's now trying to move back up to the front. We'll have to see if their strategy works. The number three is in.
They were waiting to follow the 14 car, the Vassar Silva Lexus, on what they were going to do, but they finally audible to their own game plan. The three is here on pit lane. Michelin tires going on, waiting for that fuel. About another 4 seconds. Fuel on the three, Hannah.
Bill Oberlin brings his Turner Motorsports BMW in. Again, being held right now for the team to get that full BP Racing fuel. They went ahead and put brand new Michelins on it as well. And you can see here the Acura for Gradient Racing right now with Catherine Legg getting that full BP Racing fuel fill up here with their team. So away they go. And the Volt 77 came in for a full fuel top as well.
Saw that number panel on the side of the NSX counting up. And that tells you how long that fuel stop has been going. 30 seconds was the number when Catherine Legg left pit lane, so.
He knew it was gonna be this out lap on the undercut, as we call it, taking those missions a little bit earlier. Did Jordan Taylor do some fuel save, so maybe his fuel stop's a little bit than the leading class number 14, Ben Barnacle. You'd have to think the Vassar Sullivan team has to respond here.
Looking for the 14. Looking for Jordan Taylor's lap time. 14 should be in.
I think they have to respond here.
Here they go. Yep. Talk about that long drive, that bend in pit lane. They are way down at the far end of the pit lane, and it feels like an eternity to get there. Matt?
Pit stall number one, the championship leader is in. I asked Greg Case, the team manager, this morning, one word that you think best describes this season for this 14 car, and he said execution. And then he went out about another 2 minutes of all the different things of all these crew members and just how poised and focused they've been. Michelin tires are on. You can hear him revving that engine. He just wants to gas it and get back to action here. Oh, he stalls it. Finally, that 14's away.
That's going to lose him the lead, I think. Here comes Jordan Taylor with a head of steam. Barnacle's going to try and protect, but he can't take that lane away. As in the driver briefing notes, you've got to merge safely. So that now he's off. He's lost his sync right now. He's out of his groove, out of his rhythm. Pushed too hard there. Recognized he made a mistake. Probably panicked a little bit, Brian. And that had consequences when he got down in the turn one brake zone.
Well, he's revving the engine because he's trying to keep the RPM up and keep it from bogging down. It gets a little bit rich while it's sitting there on pit lane. And then when the RPM fell and shut off, it was, like you said, a little bit of panic, trying to get it refired, get it going. We talked about this earlier. All of a sudden, it feels like the time speeds up and you've been sitting there for 10 or 15 seconds. You haven't. Go through the process, get it back going, and get back underway. They've got a really good car underneath them. See if they can hunt down Jordan Taylor. Hunting him down is one thing, getting past him is another.
Yeah, and this corner that Jordan Taylor is now encountering here, this is where Ben Barnacle has to be careful. He's going to be up on the wheel trying to push, but he's got to be careful. He's got to manage it. Hit his marks, he does that nicely. That is a corner you can't rush when the tires don't have their full temperature and grip available to you.
What is Jordan Taylor seeing as he comes out of hog pen down the front straightaway? You know that his crew is probably on the radio going, gotta go, 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 go. This is his view.
That's what you see. So Barnacle has to say to the right-hand side of the line there as you exit pit lane, but then you got to merge safely. And that'd have been too risky to try and take that fast lane away. So we talk about execution for the 14 squad. It's been perfect execution by this three team in terms of Jordan probably doing a little bit of fuel save, great pit stop, great launch compared to the 14 with their little delay with Ben stalling the car.
So much more than just driving the race car fast, isn't it? There's a plan behind it. There's a team behind it. And everything has to work. It has to fire on all cylinders, so to speak.
And Corvette put the pressure on. Ben Barnacle would have known that Jordan Taylor was in a lap early, and they know that they're trying to go for the undercut. And that just amps everything up there when you're trying to get out of your pit box.
Right on board with Catherine Legg for the number 66. Things cycling through now with the pit stops. And Catherine Legg being shown 10th right now. Actually, she drops one position to 11th as she crosses the line. This Gradient team has learned a lot this year. They've been consistent right there, 8, 9, 10 kind of finishes, sometimes 11th or so. So they've had a good run. They've learned a lot. Understand the car 70 now is going to have a penalty for working under the car while refueling. We were talking about doing everything right in the pit box. Well, that's not right. You can't get underneath the car unless they're on jack stands, and you certainly can't get underneath the car when the fuel is going in.
Oh, that's a mistake by that team. It's something you don't typically see as a well-oiled machine led by Bas Landers there. So that's going to really hurt them. We talk about them knocking on the door for their first win. They certainly had a potential podium here today, but that's going to really drive them back in this field. It's going to actually make a BMW 1-2-3. You got Snow and Foley running 1-2, Oberlin in P4, and he'll be promoted up to that podium spot here. Shandoff serves that penalty.
BMW is so strong this weekend, and you talk about Bill Oberlin, the winningest driver in IMSA history, but he's running third right now to two young guns out in front of him. Does he know kind of where his career is? I mean, obviously, Bill Oberlin's still very quick, right? But this is not Bill Oberlin of 20 years ago, right? I mean, so you find other ways to win. It's not just on sheer speed. You've got a book that you can carry with you, but how does that sit with him?
Well, I think he's just such a feisty competitor. He tries to figure out a way to make it happen in terms of raw pace when you're out there on a qualifying run. Maybe the 20, 30-year-old has a little bit more pace than you, right? But when it comes to experience, as you said, the winningest driver in IMSA history, he actually broke that record here back in 2020. Very emotional moment when he got win number 61, breaking that win number 60, I think it was, breaking Scott Pruitt's record. But he has passion to get the job done and to get the best result he can.
Like quarterbacks in football, as they get up there a little bit, maybe they can't scramble the way that they used to, but they have the experience. They know when to get rid of the ball. They know how to still win. Somebody else that knows how to win? Matt, you're standing there with them.
And we do have the championship point leader. You can see the one car, Madison Snow, out on the track behind the wheel. I've caught up with Brian Sellers. And Brian, we talked about just the only change that you really make mentally at this juncture of the season. Is it more so of your surroundings, and is that a great example when the 14 and the 3 were battling right with you?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's being aware situationally where you're at, and they certainly aren't the ones we're battling. And you know, we've had some really good races with the 14 this year, and it's been pretty clean. I would say that was on the edge. It was a pretty big risk for them when I think we weren't really off pace. But you know, you have to look at those scenarios and decide that it doesn't hurt us. Loses our buffer to the cars behind, but, you know, so you just let them go and run it as clean as you can and then go back to running your race.
When you have a 200-point lead, many people would say, sitting home, oh, they've got it in the bag, they know it. But you know, for example, back in 2018, you were in that situation, and then you went into Petit with a single-digit lead.
Yeah, I mean, you look at these scenarios and anything can happen. I mean, something just as simple as today where, you know, I feel very under the weather, and, you know, we're lucky we have Madison to put back in, but, you know, even in a short stint, you know, you can feel your mind start to wander. You got to kind of keep yourself together and get it back to him. So, you know, it can be self-inflicted, it can be inflicted by others, and some things can just be circumstantial. So I think you just have to keep your mindset about you and race every race and not worry about the points. Just race every race to do the best you can, and the rest falls in line.
And the rest certainly falling back in line here. They're on the drive for five, trying to knock down their season's fifth trophy.
Incredible.
You think about it too, if you change your game plan, don't change what has gotten you to where you are. And right now, where they are is leading in GTD and looking for that fifth win. Like Matt Yocum just said, this team has done such a good job all season long. Will VIR be the place that they take win number five in 2023?
America, come along with our adventure seekers and discover summer with Ford. Join friends Maisa and Leslie on an epic adventure with the capability of the Ford Bronco Sport.
Time for goat mode.
Head out with the Stevens family and stay connected with built-in Wi-Fi in the Ford Explorer.
Did you know that horses sleep standing up?
Road trip with the Sanchez family and available hands-free highway driving in the Ford F-150.
Yeah, cruising.
Scan the QR code to see how Ford can help you discover your best summer ever.
What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
That's my first race yesterday.
You're on the team, kid. It's orientation day.
Hey, new guy. Let's get you up to speed.
Punch time.
Your workspace is ready.
Looks like you got a corner office.
Be part of something greater. Toyota. Let's go places.
For some, the letter F is an obsession from the beginning. Until eventually, that obsession is harnessed. Many have experienced the power of F.
And they'll tell you what letter?
Obsession really begins with you.
For the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. After we leave VIR, it's the Brickyard, and we go to some really cool racetracks, Calvin, in the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. Doesn't get much cooler than the Indianapolis Motors.
It is going to be so cool, and these championships are ramping up as well, Brian, but to see these new hybrid machines, the GTP prototype class, compete here will be magic. We haven't been there since 2014. That race was won by Joao Barbosa, Christian Fittipaldi. But Sebastian Bourdais will be competing. He won there back in 2012 for Starworks Motorsport.
1 p.m. September 17th on NBC, and I can't wait for that one. That's going to be awesome. It's one of those racetracks that you walk into and you just get
chills.
Pretty special place, but so is Virginia International Raceway. It's Carroll Shelby that said here in 1958, 59, something like that, after racing here, he goes, one lap at VIR is like 10 at Watkins Glen. And obviously, Watkins Glen is another one of those racetracks that is steeped in history and tradition. But here at VIR, it's a pretty magical place. They've done such a great job with it after reopening in the 90s, and it just gets better every year.
Yeah, Kerrigan and the whole group there just do such a phenomenal job and make it entertaining for the fans. They accommodate the competitors. Massive investment. I mean, a lot of stuff behind the scenes. You don't see it when we're looking at the cars on the racetrack, but the safety improvements, Brian, you've been on top of this with some of your various roles in motorsport. They continue to invest and make this a very safe racetrack.
Because they understand that it's not only a spectator sport, but they've got to keep the participants safe. And it just, like I said, it just gets better every year. They've got a great medical staff here, great safety team here, responds to the incidents very quickly. They get the track, we can tell, get the track back in condition to go racing after you have big incidents. The 57, Ellis, having a good run right now. Looking at that team, fourth on the racetrack right now. Hannah, what else do they have going for them?
Well, they've had a silently stealth day, Brian. I mean, we really haven't talked about them much, and yet here they are up in the top six right now, currently running, and talking to Russell Ward and Philip Ellis prior to today's race, they just simply feel good about that Mercedes. They feel like they rolled it off of the trailer with a very good baseline setup. It's been very minimal changes. And this race last year was one where they felt like they built a ton of momentum. Qualified on the front row, of course, that pole position, had that bad first pit stop, and then had to make their way through the entire field. So talking to both the drivers, they said, we'd love to have an anticlimactic day. Let's take it easy. Let's position ourselves and not have to do all that work, because they feel like at the end here, this Mercedes could be a threat when it comes down to it.
It definitely could, but it's another one of those teams that it's just not been their year. Lady Luck has not been on their side.
It really hasn't. This 57 squad won here last year, of course, and
Just haven't really found that sweet spot again, Brian. Haven't stood on the podium yet this year. Two really talented drivers. I mean, Russell Ward has really upped his game over the last couple of years. Become a really accomplished GT racer. Philip Ellis is one of the best. Great team. And you really expected them to be challenging for the championship based on the fact they had a lot of bad luck last year. Scored a couple of victories late in the season. And I thought they were going to come out and really mount a charge, but it hasn't quite clicked this year.
And it's funny, you see it in other sports as well, where the roster on the team doesn't change, the coaching staff doesn't change, but the results just aren't the same. They're not what you expect, and they've had that kind of season. While other teams are looking forward to battling for the championship, this team may be looking forward to 2024 so they can start all over again, but they'd like to end it on a high note.
Well, they're one of those teams, if they get in a fight with a championship leader, they just go for a win. And that's why it's dangerous for these championship leaders when they're out there trying to execute, because you're going to come up against teams that are frustrated, like the Wynwood Racing team, that they haven't had the results they feel they deserve this year. And they're going to get their elbows out and make it a tough day for you.
Aaron Tielitz just behind them in the number 12, the GTD entry for Vassar Sullivan Motorsports. Remember, that team won at Watkins Glen. A great victory there for the entire team. They won in both GTD Pro and in GTD. Fourth in the championship right now. And while any shot at winning the championship for the 12 team is a long, long shot, I think they may even be mathematically possible, but there would have to be a lot of stuff goes down in front of them. They're going to do everything they can to win every time out.
It's hard to make an impression for Aaron Tielitz. I'm not sure what his situation is for next year, but he wants to finish off the season on a high note. He wants to really dictate where his future lies with his Vassar Sullivan group, or get the attention of some of the other top teams, because he certainly deserves a top ride. But right now, it's almost like you're out there in an audition to try and showcase what sort of speed you have for teams looking for next year.
Well, we said it at the beginning of the show, it's not just about winning the race or focusing on the championship. For some of these drivers, like Aaron Tielitz, maybe you're trying to build your resume. What a great place to do it with a win here at VIR. IMSA Racing on NBC Sports is brought to you by Ford, built for America. By WeatherTech, auto, home, pet. Find your fit at WeatherTech.com. And by Acura, precision crafted performance. Klaus Bachler on board the number 9, the FAF Motorsports Porsche, trying to chase down Ben Barnicot, but he is way, way down the road. And for Bachler right now, needs to just kind of survive in that damaged Porsche. On the pit stop, looks like they were able to get some tape on that right front fender after the contact he had with the 79 of Jules Gounon earlier. Car seems to be running okay. This would be a podium finish for them, but they still have a long way to go. We've got 38 minutes of change left in this event.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a head scratcher with this new Porsche this year, to be honest with you. I mean, I know the team's a little bit frustrated. I mean, they're coming off two championship seasons, winning in GTD, winning in GTD Pro. They got this new car. They won at Sebring in Middle East, so the hope was there that they can build a championship season. But if you look at today's race, Bachler's fastest lap is nearly a second slower than Ben Barnicot's fast lap aboard the Lexus. So they're trying everything. They worked some strategy magic there. Didn't quite work out as a podium run, but they need a lot more than that. And you've got to try and turn things around with a couple of races to go, try and get back in victory lane.
Look at GTD. Porsche's run 6th, 7th, and 8th there in the hands of Seb Priot, Kai Van Berlo, and Trent Hinman. Those are all three good pilots. You would expect to see those Porsches a little further up the road. So like you said, a bit of a head scratcher trying to get a handle on that Porsche. Right now, the 70 Inception. McLaren, that penalty they got earlier has set them well back in 10th position right now, trying to pick up another position. Catherine Legg just in front of Shandorf, and the young Dane, 26 years old, highly accomplished, racing all around the world, Fanatec GT Europe. He's racing in ELMS in the GT E category, racing here in the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. A lot of experience in different kinds of manufacturers' cars, but all in GT machinery.
Yeah, he's a young superstar. I mean, when you talk about this name for people who know him over in the global stage, yeah, he can get the job done, and the team's really strong. So that little error that they had working on the car will be very disappointing to them, because this could have potentially been at least their third podium in the last four races, if not knocking on the door for a win.
But that's what we talked about. It's not about just sitting in the car and making it go fast. It is a team sport. You can't ever lose sight of that. We talk about how hot it is out there for these drivers today. Well, guess what? I'm going to give a big shout out to all of our camera operators that are out there on stands around the racetrack in the sun, sweating all weekend long. But I don't like to give Matt a lot of credit, but I'll give Hannah a lot of credit. Both Matt and Hannah in fire suits out on pit lane. It's one of the things that makes our television coverage special is that they can be out there with it. And what about Mauro Fisher and Gus Sims working the cameras there on those pit stops, carrying a camera around in pit lane while wearing a fire suit and getting us all those great shots up close and personal with the pit stops? You won't find that anywhere other than with our coverage.
Yeah, it's quite the workout for the camera people, particularly on pit lane when you're lugging that big heavy camera up and down with the pit stops that we have happening and all the action on pit lane. But that was fun to see the dynamic and the visuals here. We look at Jordan Taylor out front, established just under a three-second lead over Ben Barnacourt. I think Barnacourt has just kind of said, you know what, we'll take the points here today. Would love to have followed up with another win, but that little slip there cost them the track position. And Jordan Taylor Garcia, boy, oh boy, did they want this victory. Gives them a glimmer of hope. They're cutting into that lead marginally. It'll be a 30-point swing with a win over the Lexus finishing second if they can continue to run in these positions to the checkered flag.
Jordan Taylor just a tick quicker than Barnacote right now. What are they saying to the Corvette camp, man?
35 minutes to go right now, just smooth and consistent laps, getting solid fuel numbers. Now, think back a year ago. They came to VIR, qualified second. The day was somewhat of a wash when they finished second. Right now, he's got a very nice, consistent 2.5 to 2.7 second cushion back to Barnacote in that Lexus. And, you know, great opportunity here looking at the roof cam as Jordan works up through the S's there. You see different changes in the pavement. Now, that's not patches. What they do, and they time it out to give a good distance so that that way it can go through some heat cycles, but they spray a bonding agent on the racetrack a little bit before corner entry, as you see right now going through the center of the corner to corner exit. It not only helps give a little bit extra grip as the rubber builds up, but it also helps make the asphalt last a little bit longer. The acrylic bonding, it helps keep the aggregate. Oh, as the 23 car is off the track, he's gonna work his way back on. But you can see how it helps keep the aggregate in the racetrack. And the drivers talk to Kerrigan Smith and say, look, can you stretch it out a little bit farther? And one other note I wanted to mention, you talk about the fans that have showed up. And the kids that are here, simply incredible. The Kids Club 12 and under, what the team here at VIR has done, they have created a fan fest, so to speak, for the young fans. You get a chance to go through the haulers. You get a chance to get a pit tour, watch pit practice. It's free for those that are 12 and under. And Kerrigan Smith, the track president, told me the only thing we have is every once in a while a parent goes, hey, I need to go along with my kid just to make sure he's going to be okay. And I said, is his name Brian by any chance? He said, no, but I can't confirm or deny that was a problem a year ago with some guy named Brian.
Oh, there you go. Usually, you know, I could use my pass to get in, but Kerrigan keeps an eye on me, so I can't get away with much. Saw the 23 with a problem there in turn three, kind of the NASCAR bend.
Get some help here with the 32 car, Grenier.
Yep. I think there was just a little bit of a nudge.
That's where Barkla kind of got into the back of the 79 Mercedes. That was a little bit more subtle, but it sends the 23 car, Riberas, off for a big ride there. So they'll be a bit frustrated. Came in here with a ton of momentum. We'll ride on board with them, see how this one develops. Just as he's trying to turn in, he gets that little nudge from Grenier, and that sends him to ride through the grass there.
Turns later, it's the 32 on the sister car, the 27. Just karma. Yeah. That may have been karma there.
That was down in turn one, just Grenier up on the wheel, trying to make something happen. We talked about that team coming on the back of a couple of podium finishes in the last three rounds of the championships, but on the back of a little bit with track position, and Mikhail just pushing a little bit too hard, it looks like.
Ramirez doesn't need to feel too bad. That turn three area is called NASCAR Bend, and it got that name because of a 1966 Trans Am race here He's in good company. Richard Petty, David Pearson, Curtis Turner, Wendell Scott, all went off there in that Trans Am race. And they were like, and the NASCAR guys seemed to be having a problem with it. So it was nicknamed NASCAR Bend after that. Rivera is back on track. The grass in the radiator there, the 32, could be a problem. I saw it there at the bottom, pretty well loaded, but I'm not sure if the majority of air doesn't go up above that. But when we talk about getting off the racetrack here, it's problematic. Multiple reasons. So for Jordan Taylor, he's been able to lay down laps that match or are slightly quicker than Ben Barnicot as the Corvette squad looks for win number two on the 2023 season. Close in on the 14 in the championship in GTD Pro.
WeatherTech is known for providing the ultimate protection for your vehicle with laser-measured floor liners and cargo trunk liner, along with seat protectors and seat back protectors. And now the WeatherTech Cup Foam with removable cups fits virtually any size cup holder and adjusts to fit virtually any size phone. Even allows easy access while charging. Whatever you drive, whatever phone you have, Cup Foam is the perfect fit. Order yours today at WeatherTech.com.
Michelin keeps innovating so the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years. But VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your streetcar, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute with our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
Faces Zoe Stark in a Balls Count Anywhere match.
Welcome to the big time!
Raw live Monday at 8, only on USA.
Next Sunday on NBC and Peacock, only two races remain until IndyCar crowns its champion when the racing heads to Portland. Next Sunday, 3 p.m. Eastern time on NBC and Peacock. All the rumors still swirling around in that paddock there, so that'll be interesting to watch and interesting to see if anybody can chase down below. So nine, the Porsche heads in to turn one. Cross Bachmann behind the wheel. They've had an up and down day.
They have. They keep digging. Looks like they're going to finish on the podium here. But as we said, they need a little bit more, but you can see that car has been pretty wounded with some of the battle scars that they've got through the course of the day. But great to be here at VIR and see that the Ingram Collection is represented here. They've got about $20 million worth of Porsches, Brian, here.
It's like your garage.
Yeah, right. I wish, but what a collection here. This was established back in the late 90s by Bob Ingram and his wife, Jeannie. They've become one of the top 100 collectors, renowned worldwide. Unfortunately, Bob passed away about 5 months ago, but this legacy has been continued by his sons, Rory and Cam.
What a splendid display of cars. There's a 1955 550 Spider, a 1967 906E, 1974 911 3-liter RS, 918 Spider, just superb cars. And they also have some track days that they do here at VIR, so they have a nice affiliation going on with this facility.
That's one of the things that I love about IMSA, is all the different car corrals. It's not just about Porsche. There's a Corvette corral. Name a make and a manufacturer, there's probably a corral at an IMSA event if it's a sports car. I'm not sure there's a Suburban corral for SUVs like the one that I drive. But if you drive a sports car,
don't buy a dog, then you wouldn't need such a big car.
Down through Hogpen one more time. Bachler, and you talk about the frustration of this team, really kind of anybody with this new Porsche, trying to find a handle on it. We thought coming into the season, Porsches for Porsches, that there would be places where it would shine and other places where it would suffer. It's kind of like every car. Nobody's going to be fantastic everywhere. But there really hasn't been one track where it's jumped out and said, hey, this is the kind of surface, this is the kind of layout, this is the kind of corner frequency that we like.
And we have a balance of performance that's worked on throughout the course of the season to try and equalize the various manufacturers. We mentioned 9 manufacturers in this race here today, and they've been tweaking on it, but still haven't quite found the sweet spot for this Porsche this year. But with the top teams that are campaigning it, and they've had podiums, they've had a win. Obviously, the FAF had a motorsport team had a win earlier this year, but not the consistency of results that you'd expect.
Kai Van Berlo aboard the 91. Strange exhaust note. Maybe it's just where the mic is placed versus that in the 9. But a very different exhaust note. Shouldn't sound any different. Kind of raspy sound.
That's good.
And obviously it's running well. And, you know, Kai Van Berlo is one of those drivers we've watched through the One Make series here, and obviously always very, very quick, very aggressive. Doesn't need to be right now because there's no one to be aggressive with, but watched him in different championships, and he is always up there, always on the limit.
Yeah, made a breakthrough, got that opportunity with the Ranch 74 team at the Rolex a couple of years ago, and grabbed it with both hands, ended up winning the race, and he probably wears a Rolex Daytona on his wrist or puts it on his shelf. I'm not sure where exactly keeps it, but nonetheless, the boy is fast and able to transition over to the various classes very effectively.
Saw the leader in GTD, Madison Snow, aboard the white, black and red Paul Miller Racing BMW, and then Robbie Foley there in the Turner Motorsport BMW. The BMWs have been so quick here, and then Bill Auberlin another 5 seconds back, so they are spread out, 1, 2, and 3 in GTD.
Yeah, Foley's keeping Madison Snow honest here. Foley actually has the fastest lap of the race in GTD. A couple of tenths quicker than the number one machine that leads, but just that track position was really set up by Madison Snow putting that car on the pole. Gallagher had a nice qualifying run, but a little bit deeper in the pack, as he mentioned, went on a bit of a fuel save early on to get them the track position. Leapfrog Foley immediately up into the top three, so they have had a strong run. And Bill Auberlin, as we said, just dogged determination, just trying to hang on to those two youngsters up in front of him.
We talk about the one team just finding a way. They haven't been blazingly fast in qualifying. Second pole of the year, 2 in a row. It was Road America and here at BIR. Only one other front row spot, but they've just found a way. When they've struggled at events, they've found a way to be there at the end. Watkins Glen's a good example.
Yeah, I mean, they were on the back foot, went down a lap, maybe 2 laps, and suddenly find themselves back in the big points. But now they seem to have taken it to another level, as you mentioned, with those pole positions now and leading these races. And yeah, they were dominating in terms of points, but now they're displaying almost, they've hit another gear as this season has gone on.
Riding on the board there with Bill Auberlin, and now up to the lead, Jordan Taylor. 3 seconds back to Ben Barnicote, so Taylor has grabbed the reins of that Corvette and has whipped it out in front with the mistake that happened there on the pit stop for Ben Barnicote. So that gap has remained, and Jordan Taylor seems to be in control. Is he saving fuel? Do they need to save fuel to get to the end here at VIR and find another victory?
Sunny. Thank you, Father.
Michelin keeps innovating so the world can move in better ways. Michelin, motion for life.
What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
To the Acura Summer of Performance event going on now.
VP Racing Fuels has been the official fuel of racing for over 45 years, but VP isn't just race fuels. VP offers a wide range of oils, additives, and our new Stay Frosty coolants to help keep your street car, tow vehicle, or weekend warrior running at its best. VP products are engineered to keep your vehicle running smooth and looking great for your daily commute. With our octane boosters, fuel treatments, and quick detailing products. Explore VP's full product line at vpracingfuels.com.
Saturday, it's Michigan's home opener from the Big House, followed by Notre Dame in South Bend. Then, Penn State in primetime in the premiere of Big Ten Saturday Night. Saturday on NBC and Peacock.
Back in the Michelin GT Challenge from VIR, and you ride on board the number 14 Vassar Sullivan Lexus. Ben Barnicote behind the wheel, your championship leader in GTD Pro, and the target is out in front, that bright yellow Corvette trying to slip away. It has been an eventful day, a little argy-bargy, Calvin.
Well, there's always a little bit of jeopardy, as we said here, coming to VIR. Elbows are out. This is on an outlap between Oberlin and Lenk. Shandoff trying to make a move there on Buckler. 32 and the 23. Elbows are out there through the snake. And this is where Buckler almost ran over the top of Gunnar.
Little push and shove there. The 23 off. Alex Riberas goes for a ride. It's a cage match.
It is. It is a battle. Battle of survival. What a racetrack.
And you look at it when you pull in and you go, oh, it's so wide open. It's just,
it's,
I mean,
so serene,
right? It's very
it? Yeah.
Deceptive.
You're driving into Augusta or something, and then the...
then you stand on the first tee. It is all downhill from there. Can I buy another sleeve of balls, please? Yeah, one of those.
I think some of these drivers would need another sleeve today.
Yeah, I mean...
Mulligans, maybe.
Yeah. You'd like a mulligan several times, and it's just simple things. In all seriousness, it's simple things. The car stalling on Ben Barnicote on that pit stop, that's the difference in first and second on the racetrack right now.
It is. It was going to be tight because Jordan had a lap of temperature in his tires. I think Barnicote was going to come out just in front of him. Obviously, that stall cost him 2 or 3 seconds there, but it was going to be tight. You know, Jordan was going to be up on the wheel and trying to make a move there. And who knows, at the end of the day, it could have gone wrong by executing a good pit stop, Jordan putting the pressure on. Who knows in racing what could have been the consequences of that, but they're okay. I mean, they've still got a really healthy points lead. The important thing for them is events are winding down. We only have two races to go coming out of here. They'd love to have a really strong run at Indy and maybe make it where they just have to start the race maybe at Petit Le Mans, because that one is the total unknown. We've got a massive field there this year, and trying to survive that race is mega.
Well, and that's just it. I mean, we talk about the challenge of this racetrack, and you got to get through this weekend. You really have to get through all of them. This is 2 hours and 40 minutes. So is Indianapolis. Now, the Michelin Pilot Challenge race at Indy is 4 hours, but Then you go to the 10-hour race, Petit Le Mans, where anything can happen. The traffic density is absolutely intense. The number of cars on that racetrack, nighttime, prototypes, cars that you haven't seen except in endurance races. I mean, everything gets thrown in that one. You want it wrapped up before you get there.
You'd like to, because it is such a roulette wheel there in terms of the gambles that you have to take all day long to survive, particularly in the nighttime hours. And the field, we understand this year, Brian, is going to be immense, up over 50 cars trying to survive around that relatively short racetrack compared to here at VIR.
Checking back in on our Lexus biggest movers. It's Bill Arlen that heads that list right now. Still having a good run there in third, and I would imagine the Turner Motorsports team is pleased with what they see right now with their cars in second and third. They'd rather see the BMW that leads be one of theirs, but right now Madison Snow doing a great job, and when you look at the lap times, he's just as quick, maybe a little bit quicker than Robbie Foley does, at least the last time by.
You know what, Brian, that is that the fact that when you have someone who's performing like Paul Miller Racing is, that makes your operation go to another level. I know you've been through it as a driver. I certainly have, where there's someone out there who just can't seem to quite catch. They're always just kind of got a little bit of an edge. But that makes you dig deeper. That makes you look at the details. That makes the whole organization work harder to become stronger, if not for the next race, but for next season.
And I can imagine, think back several years. I mean, Paul Miller Racing has always had a great presence at the racetrack, but it was Turner Motorsports that you looked at as BMW. They can come away with another championship this year with the performance that they've had. How do they feel when they look back? Not only that they've won, but they've won over the people that they're competing against. You always want to win, but it feels even better when you beat the best, does it not?
It does. I mean, it's a real feather in the cap of that organization. I mean, we mentioned the fact earlier in the show that they got started late. They didn't get the supply of the car in time for Rolex, which they knew. That was all predetermined when they made the decision at the end of 2021 to switch to BMW. They won the Sprint Cup last year, which was really their target. It's like, what can we win this year? Let's go after the Sprint Cup, which is a championship within the championship. It discounts all of the endurance racing points and just gives points for doing the sprint races. So they won that, and then they just come out of the box this year and potentially winning their fifth race out of nine is just a remark. They continue to build those numbers, maybe to a level that will never be matched again.
When you always want to find the silver lining, and I think the silver lining for Trent Hinman in that bright yellow Volt number 77 Porsche is that he's running right there with that organization in that car, the exact same car that's in front of him with the Porsche factory driver on board. And you measure yourself that way, and it's kind of a resume builder as well, is it not? Hey, look what I can do. Look who I can run with in the exact same equipment.
Well, Trent's been a champion at this level before, but then he made the move to partner up with Adam Brynjolfsson. They won a GT4 championship together, the Michelin Pilot Challenge, and then they made the decision to step up to the WeatherTech Championship with this Porsche. And it's been tough. I mean, it is really a deep water that you're suddenly throwing yourself into. And they've had a podium run this year, and they're continuing to build. John Wright has an awesome group there of engineers to just continue to work hard and just try and make this program stronger and stronger.
John Wright has so much experience. Bockler lets him go. I think at that point in time, he realized there was absolutely no reason to be too involved. That was easy for Hinman to get by. Bockler holding down the third position. And if you look at pit stops, he should be fine on fuel.
I think pretty much everyone out there seems to be in the window to be able to get to the finish right now. So I don't think anyone's got any fuel issues. I think you had to be a bit mindful, let's call it. You went on full fuel save, but I think for the three car, we were on board with Jordan Taylor a couple of times where I felt like he was sailing into the brake zone, so he's not running the gas pedal all the way up to where he hits the brake pedal, just coasting a little bit to get a little bit of fuel save, just to be sure.
Well, if you can do it and not lose time to your nearest competitor, why not do it? Just to have, like you said, just to be sure that little bit of insurance. One of the other corners that's so intimidating here, turn 10, that super high-speed left-hand corner.
Come down to gear for there, a little bit of braking, but then I think that next one is the one that can really trip you up. Turn 11 before Oak Tree, that tight right-hander onto Madison Avenue. Surprised we haven't seen more offs there. I think people must have seen enough video of cars going off there over the course of this weekend to keep it clean today. Madison Snow from the pole. Commanded the lead early, but Brian Sellers behind the wheel. He did his usual stellar job. Madison just trying to ride it home.
We talk about looking forward to 2024. This team will make the move to the pro category. Same team, same car, same lineup. This is a really good indication of where they're going to slot in.
Yeah, they're third on the road right now. There's only two of the pro cars ahead of them. And I think you'd have to feel like, you know, if they were battling the number three and the number 14, they may have even a little bit more pace to show. So, yeah, it's going to be fascinating to see them finally step up to the pro ranks. I mean, Madison has been graded silver of late, and his form is just excellent. I mean, his qualifying performances and his race pace. I mean, they got their first victory here together back in 2016, I think it was, as a team. And as with a driver partnership, they won a championship back in 2018 together. They just continue to run at a very high level.
Robbie Foley continuing to put good laps in, but looks like he's backed off the pace a few tenths, or Madison Snow has picked up the pace, however you want to look at it. But that gap between their lap times has changed a little bit. You talked about Jordan Taylor saving fuel. Wondering if there would be any reason for Robbie Foley to be saving fuel in the 96. I know, Hannah, you're monitoring their radios. What are you hearing down there?
Yeah, Brian, and I think that's actually, you mentioned it, Robbie Foley backing off, that team talking to him, and they're continually communicating those fuel numbers that he's seeing here on the BMW, and they said you should be able to make it, but it's going to be very close. And keep in mind here, of course, Robbie Foley with his 96 machine came in one lap earlier than the 97 of Oberlin, and of course the team making that conscious decision to bring them in on separate laps. So it's going to be very close for him. The team saying, okay, reel it back in a little bit. We're already very close, so don't overpush it. Let's go ahead and be content with the second place run here.
Sometimes, you know, when you want to move up in championships, you finish in the position that your car will allow you to finish in, and that seems like Turner Motorsports' plan today. If you got a second place car, finish in second place. That's their target right now. We'll be back for the checkered flag, VIR.
What happened to driving? When did it lose its soul? We believe driving should be more than just getting from A to B. It's time to breathe new life into the art form. One gear at a time, one shift at a time. This feeling isn't going anywhere. The world may have forgotten, but Cadillac hasn't. The Cadillac V-Series Blackwing.
Lexus. Our motto is you have to feel it to believe it. Experience the exhilaration of the Lexus Performance Line.
Football is on NBC and Peacock. First up, only on Peacock, it's Michigan's home opener from the Big House. Then on NBC and Peacock, the Fighting Irish look to take care of business at their home opener in South Bend. And in prime time, it's the premiere of Big Ten Saturday Night with West Virginia, Penn State from Happy Valley. Saturday on NBC and Peacock.
Next Sunday, the Premier League is on NBC, and Peacock as two bitter rivals clash in London. Arsenal versus Manchester United next Sunday, 11:30 Eastern Time on NBC and Peacock. And I know where Calvin will be.
He took the words out of my mouth.
I know you too well.
Yeah, I love it.
Who's going to win?
Arsenal were tough last year. They almost got the championship. Manchester City pipped them at the line, but Man U got a really strong squad, so it's going to be an exciting match.
A little bit of history there.
Yeah.
No, 116th meeting, I think this is going to be.
No, it's, I mean, the rivalries are big. The squads these days, there's so much quality in terms of the top teams. Their bench is stronger than some of the lower-ranked teams, so it's amazing.
It's like the depth here in IPSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. We talk about the depth of field in the GTD category. Frederick Chandorf aboard the 70, the McLaren, the Inception Racing McLaren, trying to fight back from that penalty and just continuing to push forward one car at a time. The next one in his sights, Kai Van Berlo. This one may not be as easy as some of the other ones had been, because Van Berlo is going to be holding on tight to that seventh position.
Yeah, you know, the when you're on the back foot, he went from third down to 10th in class with that drive-through penalty. So each competitor you catch is going to be a little bit stronger, a little bit faster, a little bit more determined to hang on, and particularly when there's only 5 and a bit minutes to go.
And even though it's, quote, only for seventh position, again, for these young drivers, every time they're in the car, they're padding their resume. They're adding something else, something to the highlight reel that they can use to make the next step, move a little bit farther up the ladder.
You're spot on. You never want to be beat. You never want to be overtaken. You take it personally. You do. You mean, you just have a sense that your ego gets in the way. You just don't want to suddenly be passed with 5 minutes to go. But Chandorf has a big run. He's going to be to the left there. So Van Berlo kind of stuck in the middle of the road. Try to make him go the long way around by the time you get to this right-hander. So he's going to have to play some games here with the pace of that McLaren here to keep him behind for another 3 or 4 laps.
Going to have to work really hard, and I think too, by the end of the stint, as good as the official tires are, I think Van Berlo's may be gone a little bit then. Perhaps the McLaren a little nicer to those Michelins over the length of the stint, even though he has pressed as hard as he has to move back up the order. Maybe he's got a little better rubber underneath him right now. On board the 57 of Philip Ellis.
Yeah, we're talking about a BMW 1-3. Well, Philip Ellis, who won here last year, may have other thoughts about that. He has caught Bill Oblin. So as we talk about Robbie Foley maybe having to drive with a little bit of fuel save in mind, if Bill Oblin's having to do the same thing, admittedly, and alluded to the fact that he pitted a lap later than Foley did in terms of fuel, he can't afford to back off too much, otherwise Ellis is going to nip that final podium spot.
I find it fascinating, the ebb and flow of these sports car races based upon the strategy and what you're doing fuel saving wise and so on and so forth. It can look like someone's got a massive lead and all of a sudden they don't. It can look like someone's out of the game, but all of a sudden they've saved enough fuel that they can turn it back on at the end and press forward. And it's why you never want to go away, because it's never over until it's over.
Some drivers don't like to hear much over the radio. I'd be one of the guys, I'd want to know, okay, you want me to save fuel, what is the risk? Where is the next car? What pace is he still doing? And I'd want that information, because you don't want to suddenly say, oh, I'm going to save fuel, and then next thing you look in your rearview mirror or the rearview facing camera, and that Mercedes is right there. And it's like, well, where did he come from? You told me to back it off a little bit, and now we're vulnerable for keeping this podium. But Bill's going to get his elbows out of the field. Not really in a championship position to be a threat. So it's all about podiums and wins.
But again, for a driver like Bill Oblin, with the massive experience that he has and trying to hold on to that reputation that he has as the winningest driver in IMSA, you talk about egos that are involved. I mean, he's not egotistical. He's one of the greatest guys you'll ever run into, but he's egotistical when he gets in the race car. He doesn't want to be beaten.
He has a lot of pride.
Yeah, absolutely.
Here we go. This is a good little battle right here.
That's Kai Van Berlo again. Yeah, the Inception McLaren going at it. We knew it was going to be tough. I told you that when Chandorf gets there, Van Berlo is going to be a handful.
Yeah, and he's just positioning himself on the straightaways. Where he's vulnerable at season of the McLaren is at the end of the straightaways, into 14, into turn one. But he's making Chandorf go the long way around and then fighting him coming off the corners. Great little scrap here.
Not much doing up through here. You can't really get anything done through the snake or the climbing S's, but you can at 11 and 12, but it's got to be a forceful move. And how good is the McLaren in that low speed cornering? How stable is it? Can he put it up alongside, headed into turn 12?
Well, it's tough. It's tough to make the tires work as Van Berlo gets the tires a little bit dirty. That's not going to help his grip here. Shandoff not thinking of going underneath their apex. He's thinking about getting a good run here. Now, Van Berlo's got a problem because Shandoff was on him really early. That was tight. That was one. That was really tight. And I think Shandoff's going to clear him.
Trying to use a little side drafting to see if he can slow him down a little bit, but there were definitely a couple of moves there. And now Shandorf returns the favor and says, you did it to me, I'm doing it to you.
He knows all about that little slip that we saw Van Berlo have on the exit of turn 10, going into 11, so he was a little bit vulnerable, didn't get the clean exit, and McLaren did. And before Van Berlo could block, Shandorf had pounced and got alongside him.
And I think race control will look at that and go, yes, the 91 block, and probably about to push the button and call the warning in, and then watch the 70 and went, okay, well, turnabout's fair play, off we go kind of thing.
Oh, look at this. This is where the Mercedes is good, and he dives to the inside. Beautifully set up there by Philip Ellis. Just kept it nice and close. BMW stretches its legs down the front straightaway, but Ellis really executed a superb run through the first sector. And that is a definite opportunity when the tires are a little bit later in life. The car in front of you just can't carve the corners quite as effectively, and he pounced.
Ellis demonic on the brakes. The car looks so stable from the onboard. Not a lot of twitching, moving around there in that Mercedes, able to take the position. Bill Auberlin somewhat defenseless there, couldn't do anything about it once the Mercedes was alongside.
And I think for Robbie Foley's sake, maybe got enough of a gap here because Ellis is on a charge here late in the going.
Back up front, Jordan Taylor down the front straightaway. 20 seconds left on the clock. It'll be about 15 seconds left on the clock. You go past the start-finish line. Last lap, final lap for the number three. It'll be checkered flag next time by. And that lead that he had over Ben Barnicote is now a second and a half. Barnicote has been closing the gap a little bit, catching Corvette is one thing. Getting past him on the last lap is something entirely different. White flag now for Madison Snow aboard the one.
Snow still up on the wheel. You can see him working it. Having every ounce of grip out of that BMW on his final lap. What a performance.
There's a danger in backing up, right? And kind of relaxing a little bit. You've been on it the entire time, and if you just relax a little bit, all of a sudden you're not where you need to be and you're still going really fast, and a mistake can jump out at you very, very quickly.
Yeah, he's just feeling it for Jordan Taylor. Critical corner again. Don't overcharge the entry at turn 11. Nice clean exit here. It looks like he's got enough in hand. Barnicote's going to keep him honest here. Three corners to go.
And for Ben Barnicote, in the following Lexus, the number 14, he sees it and he can almost grab the Corvette that is in front of him. He's probably thinking five more minutes. Can we just run for five more minutes? The races used to be 2 hours and 45 minutes long. Can we run in five more minutes? It might have been a different thing, but woulda, shoulda, coulda, and mighta, it's a different thing. It doesn't work well in racing. What has worked well in VIR is the number three Corvette, both from a driver's perspective and from the engineering perspective. Corvette Racing, Antonio Garcia, Jordan Taylor, the win at VIR. That's win number two of the 2023 season, and they'll close the gap just a little bit to the number 14 in the GTD Pro Championship. Number one now on the front straightaway. This is rarefied air. You said it, Calvin. Five wins. No one has done that in GTD and IMSA competition, but Paul Miller Racing, Madison Snow, Brian Sellers have with a win here at VIR.
Just superb. What a day.
Wow, good stuff. Great stories. And as we look down the road, at least in GTD Pro, that championship is still open. Brian Sellers, Madison Snow doing everything they can to wrap it up in GTD. We'll wrap it up when we come back to VIR. The celebrations in the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. Looking down on the winners here at VIR, both GTD Pro and GTD, the Corvette, that bright yellow number three, the white BMW just behind, Michelin GT Challenge at VIR. And while they head to pit lane and the champagne is chilling, take a look at our BMW race results, unofficial race results, of course, until after cars clear tech and so on and so forth. There they are right there in GTD Pro. We talked about it. That little mistake on the pit stop, Calvin, catapults the three up front. Championship still alive.
It is. There's a glimmer of hope. They need to really sweep the table. They need to go three on the trot here and hope that the 14 caused some kind of drama in the last couple of events, but there's still a chance.
Well, and Corvette Racing has done such before, so they could do it again. Looking at GTD, Snow and Sellers, it seems like they can do no wrong, but still, we've got a long way to go.
You run out of superlatives, but their lead in the championship now is massive. But anything can happen with the depth of field in GTD. It means there's a bigger point swing each and every weekend, and you have to survive Petit Le Mans as well.
Saw the Inception Racing team, the number 70 there in seventh. Great run back from the problems that they had. Another top 10 finish for Catherine Legg and Sheena Monk. And then really disappointing, the 92, that problem early for David Brulé. That's not the way you want to go out here at BIR. So a tough day for that team. Winners have arrived in victory lane. Matt, watch out for champagne corks flying.
And down in victory lane, the 115th win for Corvette Racing. In fact, Jordan Taylor asked, could he do a burnout? They said, we don't think we have enough fuel for a burnout, but he certainly had enough fuel to get it to the end. And certainly, this is one big family at Corvette Racing, and Jordan Taylor said he's going back to his family's team, but he wanted to end this magical period of his racing career on such a high note. And Antonio, what a day!
Yeah. What a comeback after what happened at Road America, so team deserves this, and Jordan did an amazing job today. He was like a switch clock, so very good.
I didn't feel like a switch clock. I felt like more like a Chinese-made clock, but man, it was amazing. I mean, yeah, that's down to Corvette Racing calling that strategy to get us that track position, and then, yeah, when they told me the fuel number, I was definitely worried, but yeah, the car was so good, even in fuel-save mode, it actually helped me save the tires, so yeah, I mean, I know the announcement recently has come out, so I'm glad to give these guys one back.
All right, looking ahead, they'd love to close out this period with a win at Petit two races from now. Hannah.
Back-to-back sweeping weekends for the Paul Miller Racing BMWs of Madison Snow and Brian Sellers. Five wins on the 2023 season. Never been done before in GTD competition like this. At what point in this season did you guys realize you were setting yourself up for a record-breaking year?
I mean, it was the second half of the year where we really took off. I mean, the first half, we had a good beginning of the year. Sebring went awesome for us. But the second half of the year, we really had a momentum going.
At one point, we had four BMWs in the top five here in GTD competition today. What is it about this racetrack that simply fired well for that manufacturer with you guys?
Well, I think it's a combination of things. The BMW was obviously fantastic today, and Madison did a great job. I think one of the things that fits it the most is the high-speed nature of the track. You know, there's a lot of places where it's small and tight and the car struggles, but here at VIR, where it's wide and sprawling, it really stretches its legs, so we're super happy to be a part of it.
Back-to-back weekends here for the Paul Miller Racing Team. Two wins now in a row, five for the season. Guys, we still have two races left. Do we see six, maybe seven for this team?
Hell, you don't know. There's a look at GTD Pro driver points right now. Garcia and Taylor, 144 markers back.
Yeah, it's tightened up. It's 169 coming into the weekend, so there's a glimmer of hope. They still need a bad weekend for the 14 team, and they don't seem to be having many of those this year.
And in GTD, Madison Snow, Brian Sellers, like you said, you run out of superlative.
Well, it's incredible. 375-point lead, so they have a lot to work with. They just have two average results to finish out the year. The championship will be theirs, and it'll be deserved.
Well, they're going to have to get through Indy. That's next, and you're not going to want to miss that one. September 17th, the Battle of the Bricks. For Hannah Newhouse, Matt Yoakum, Calvin Fish, I'm Brian Till. Congratulations to our winners in both Pro and in GTD. It was a hot one here at VIR. It's going to stay hot at Indy.